But this is the one he's been waiting for.
Obviously, this game represents a possible national championship, so I think the people in Nebraska are very excited, very interested in this particular game. I think our players are, coaches, so there's a lot to play for.
It's been 7 weeks since the Hurricanes have seen action on the field, and the Cornhuskers had to come here early to escape a Midwest deep freeze and to adapt to the heat and humidity. So the past week has been one of intensive training for both teams to prepare for tonight's game. Yet their coaches took the time to clue us in on what to expect. For instance, in their game plans.
This is going to be a wide open, throw it over their head after we get them running to stop that, catch it in front of them type of a game. We're going to screen and draw and do those types of things. And there might be a place for something that we haven't done before.
Offensively, we adjust to what we see. You know, if they come up with an eight-man front, then we're going to throw the ball more. If they play, you know, a lot of zone, we'll run it more. I don't know. We usually adjust to what we're seeing, and we have no preconceived ideas right now. So let's go out and play real hard. I think we'll play well. I think we'll take care of the ball. I think you'll see a lot of effort on both sides.
Or in Miami's defense against what has been termed the greatest offensive line in the history of college football.
We're not going to be able to stop their offense, but if we can contain it, if we can keep their point production within reach of our offense, then I think our offense has a real chance to win the football game.
Defensively, we've at times been a little inconsistent, and yet offensively, Oklahoma State held us to 14 points, you know, so I don't know what'll happen, but I think that we're capable of being awfully good, but I think Miami is too. I think any time a team has won 12 straight like we have, and Miami's won 10 straight, they've got a lot of momentum, they've got to have great athletes, and that'll be a great football game.
Or in scoring, though Nebraska's the highest scoring team in college football history, tonight may be different.
I think it's going to be a medium scoring game. I think it'll be in the 20s, and I think the team that makes the plays in the fourth quarter will be the team that'll come out with the win.
I suppose that's a fairly good observation, although there's been some games when we've had it put away by the fourth quarter. I don't think that will happen in this case. I think they're too good a football team. I think we're too good for them to have it put away by the fourth quarter, so it probably will come down to the fourth quarter of football and who can play the best at that time.
There's no question about it. Anyone who follows college football will be awaiting the outcome of tonight's game. But for both coaches involved, half the victory is already here in making it to the 1984 Orange Bowl.
I'll be thinking this is the biggest game that I've been in my professional career. It's a real honor to be a part of something like this. And although we're going to make every effort to win, and we'll be awfully disappointed if we don't, the mere fact that this football team has played well enough to get to this game means an awful lot to them personally as well as it does to this program.
And I think we're well prepared. And beyond that, there's not much I can do. You know, if Miami's better than we are, then we'll just go over and shake their hands and wish them well, you know. And if they're not, well, then we'll win the national championship, and that'll be nice.
When it's over, we'll be a very happy victor. We'll be a very happy loser.
Coming up, more U.S.
He's phenomenal. I wouldn't want anybody else leading us into the Orange Bowl because I think he's going to pick Nebraska apart.
He's the one that's, you know, taken us this far, you know, and no other quarterback's been able to do it, including Jim Kelly. And he's just a great person all around, you know. He gets along with everybody and great team leader.
When we get out on the field, we know he's got what it takes, and especially the last two games when we had to make key drives at the very end of the game. And that means a lot to us, knowing that when we have to have it, we've got it with Bernie.
It's not hard to figure out who these University of Miami football players are talking about tonight. 20-year-old Bernie Cool Hand Kosar, the redshirted freshman quarterback for the Hurricanes, is one of the main heroes in the spotlight. Why? Because he led the hometown to a 10-1 season, which clinched the bid for the Orange Bowl against the Nebraska Cornhuskers. It's been 33 years since Miami has gone to this major bowl, and South Florida has Orange Bowl fever. Part of it is due to the 6'5", 195-pound gangly quarterback. Bernie credits his success to his teammates and head coach, Howard Schnellenberger.
It's a maturing of a lot of good young athletes, a lot of hard work and dedication by a coaching staff, by a group of young athletes, and the direction that Bernie has given them has gone a long way to make all their efforts pay off.
Bernie hasn't always been the center of attention on the playing field. In fact, last year he sat on the bench all season and trained to slip his size 13 feet into the shoes of UM's last great quarterback, Jim Kelly. This season, Coach Schnellenberger had a tough decision. Who to pick for the number one job? There were three very talented quarterbacks vying for the position. During the first day of practice, Bernie shined, throwing for more yards than his two competitors put together. Commander Kosar was the clear winner.
I think the key to it is, especially from my position, knowing what's going on around you, knowing where the people are, where the defense, you know, what defense they're in, and where your people are going to be on every play.
I'm naturally very happy and proud, kind of like a new father as he sees his young son grow and develop.
This 3.4 grade point average finance and economics major and star quarterback comes from a small township in Ohio called Boardman. Population, 40,000. On a recent trip to Ohio, we found out how Bernie's parents felt about their son's success.
Up until this football season, I was naive enough to think there was no upper limit on my imagination. And now I know there is, because I absolutely could not have written this scenario.
I'm awfully proud of him. I think he's a great kid. Even though he brings me his laundry to do.
It's easy to see why Bernie is so good at what he does. He might not be the best overall athlete, but his intelligence makes up for it. He can read defenses and he understands Miami's complicated multiple offensive formations. He also has an incredibly accurate arm. But most importantly, he can withstand the pressure and keep cool in hot situations. With a winning combination like Bernie, success leads the way.
Something that throwing a football and being out there just seems to come natural to me, and something I enjoy, so that's why I keep playing.
Bernie Kosar has done well because he's Bernie Kosar, and I think a lot of coaches could do just as well with the talented young man that he is, but I'm happy to be a part of it, and it's very satisfying to see him perform so well.
Along with his coaches and teammates, Bernie Kosar is certainly made of the right stuff, the stuff heroes are made of. Courage, determination, intelligence, and guts. And if there's anyone Miami would like to have leading them into the Orange Bowl tonight, it certainly seems to be Bernie Kosar.
We can make miracles together. We're supernatural tonight.
Thanks, Dick. Here at the Orange Bowl, we're getting set for the national championship game. The Nebraska Cornhuskers with that 52-point-a-game offense gets there running the ball. Miami John has a great passer, and he's young.
Well, not only do they have a great passer, he's a freshman, 6'5", 205 pounds.
So we're looking at it strictly in that light, an opportunity for us to become one of the top teams in the country.
Linebacker Jay Brophy, a Miami All-American, keys a Hurricane defense that allows less than 10 points a game. But if Miami is to upend the number one team, quarterback Bernie Kosar of the Hurricanes has to have a big game. He's a freshman, but plays like a veteran. Kosar to Eddie Brown could be the key. We'll be back after these messages from your local station. National championship of college football is about to be decided. Miami, Florida, city of light for the golden anniversary game of the Orange Bowl, and the weather in South Florida is just right for this most important college football game. Number one Nebraska, with a 12-0 record under Coach Tom Osborne, needing one more victory for the national title, goes against a much smaller but a very physical, tough University of Miami team under Howard Schnellenberger that has won 10 straight games. And now with the upset today of Texas, Miami is in the hunt for the national championship. Schnellenberger and his Miami Hurricanes, geared and ready. They've not played in 7 weeks. They've been off since their last game, November 12th, but they're on the home field. And in 5 years under Schnellenberger at the Orange Bowl, the Miami Hurricanes have won 24 games and lost two. They're the underdog, according to the oddsmakers, but they don't think so. An optimistic and prepared team, ready to take on one of the great teams in college football history, the Nebraska Cornhuskers. We'll be back with the golden anniversary. Cricky with John Brody back at the Orange Bowl. We're ready to kick it off. Nebraska getting here with a perfect 12-0 mark. The Huskers started fast, blew out Penn State, a giant stadium in the Meadowlands, and on they roll, averaging 52 points a game. They scored more points this season than any team in NCAA history. Miami knocked out at Florida early in the season, and then the Miami Hurricanes started to roll. 10 consecutive victories. One big and one when they had to come from behind, but they won.
It looked to me like Nebraska's, when they posted those scores, looked like the end of a basketball season.
They score like a basketball team, the Huskers, averaging 52 points a game. Miami has won the toss, but the Hurricanes want to establish their defense against Nebraska's great offense, and Miami has elected to kick off. Jeff Davison, he's not big, but he can kick it deep, ready to hit the ball now for the Hurricanes, and there are two great players. Irving Fryer is back deep, ready to take the kickoff, and back with him is Mike Rozier, 6 yards deep in the end zone, and he is counseled not to bring it out. And so, the Huskers go on offense, first and 10 at their 20. And there's the whip cracker, the man who makes the Huskers go, quarterback Turner Gill. The fullback, big and very quick Mark Schilling, the Heisman Trophy winner Mike Rozier, averaging almost 8 yards a carry. Irving Fryer's another great threat at the wingback position. Ricky Simmons, they don't go to him often, but he can catch the ball and he blocks. And Engebritsen, the tight end, is a blocker primarily. So we're ready to go. Nebraska. First and 10 from the Huskers 20. They're going to put it up. Turner Gill throws, and he's got his wing back. Irving Fryer didn't get much. He was hit at about the 24-yard line as Coach Osborne now sends in the play. Ken Siska, linebacker, knocked him down. Mark Denning, one of the Nebraska tackles, 300 pounds. Henry Grimminger, the other offensive guard. Next to him, Mike Trainowitz is the center and a good one. Dean Skynkuhler, probably the best. Lombardi and Outland winner. Scott Rarden, he's over 300 pounds at right tackle. They got Biggins and the bookends, John.
Don, you can slide all the stats you want about that offensive line, but I'll tell you another one. They average 9 letters per last name right across the line. That means they've got a lot of long names and a lot of big fellas. 270-pound average. And they move people around.
Well, those jerseys are broad enough to carry a lot of letters. And now it's going to be second down and 5 for Nebraska. Opening series of downs. The option, Turner Gill, a pitch back to Rozier, and he's open. Rozier is an open field. And finally, Reggie Sutton knocks him down as Mike Rozier almost breaks at the distance. Good for a 27-yard gain and a first down for the Huskers.
Don, to talk about what kind of a feat that is, and we may see a bit more of that today. The Hurricanes have allowed only one running back all year long to gain over 20 yards. That was a 28-yarder. This is the second longest run against this defense all year long by the Heisman Trophy winner. I guess it figures.
And right now, Nebraska breaks the front of the Miami Hurricanes and goes back to Rozier. And again, the power run. And look at Rozier rip it open all the way down to the 30. A free football, though. They're going to rule he's down. The officiating crew from the Southeast Conference, an 18-yard gain on that carry by Mike Rozier. Danny Brown knocked him down as the huge Nebraska front just overpowering Miami these last two plays.
Well, the coaches were a little concerned. They're not going to blitz, I don't think, as much as they normally would because they want a lot of pursuit. They don't want their linebackers out of position, but Rozier has run right through their position.
First and 10, Nebraska. Free football. A free ball at the 30-yard line, but a Cornhusker, it looks like Scott Rarden or Dean Steinkuhler came up with the ball, so they keep it. Danny Brown's a defensive end. They're small, more like outside linebackers. Kevin Fagan, a good pass rusher at 265 pounds. Key player for Miami is the middle guard, Tony Fitzpatrick. And Fred Robinson, not heavy, but very, very fast. Julio Cortez, outside on the left side. Jay Brophy gained All-America mention as a linebacker, and Ken Siska is the leading tackler for Miami. First back through is Shaleen, and Brophy is waiting for him. short gain, it'll be third and long. And the penalty markers down. Reggie Sutton, one corner. They're very hard-hitting, quick corners. Eddie Williams plays free safety. Kenny Calhoun, he'll blitz a lot, and Rod Bellinger's had a great year as the strong corner, comes out on the same side as the tight end.
That's a play we've seen an awful lot of this year, Don. It's one of those both teams have a little personal grudge against one another. Cornerback and wide receiver get after it. They do throw a penalty to tell them to cool down, but no harm. No foul.
Offsetting penalties. And so it'll be third down and eight again, and they'll go from the 28-yard line. Nebraska looking for a national championship. They've not had one since 1971, and Tom Osborne's had great teams, but never has gone the distance.
Let's see if that stat stays up.
Third and eight, Huskers. No score in the first quarter. Turner Gill all day long fires, and he has a man that's broken up. He was going to... Bellinger was there to break it up. So now, an interesting dilemma for Osborne and the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Fourth down and eight coming up. They've only tried four field goals all year. And the punter doesn't play in a lot of games.
That's the area where you can see the packed Orange Bowl. This is the area where they take four downs to get there first. This is an exception. They feel they have a kicker can kick it 44 yards.
Livingston's the man who will try it. The 45-yard attempt. Turner Gill, the quarterback, will hold. It is down. It's blocked. Miami has the football. So the Miami Hurricanes have this place in absolute pandemonium. They've captured this town. Is in jubilation over a blocked field goal.
The special teams knew they had to come up with some kind of a big play to get something happening early in the ball game. They did that. Remember, this team has kicked only four field goals all season. That's the least in modern football history. They made a big play against a weak group.
The game, it is nothing-nothing first quarter. Bernie Kosar, a 6'5" freshman quarterback, directing the Miami offense, but he plays like a veteran. And he comes out of firing. Wide open is Stanley Shakespeare. He's down to the 34-yard line.
When you take a look, when you're talking about Bernie Kosar, you're talking about a fellow that's quite rare indeed. Now he's got his man down the field. He's in a perfect position. Got to throw it over the top of two linebackers. Throws it to Stanley Shakespeare. Picks up a first down. The first play of the evening is a big one.
Real big one. The Miami Hurricanes come out of firing, and now they have the ball inside the 35-yard line of Nebraska. First and 10. Second back throw is Keith Griffin. Archie's little brother takes it inside the 25-yard line, and he has a first down for Miami. By Nissan, who invites you to see the new 1984 Nissan 300ZX at your Datsun dealer now. By Goodyear Tires and Goodyear Service for more good years of your car. By Anheuser-Busch St. Louis, brewers of Michelob, some things speak for themselves. And by Mutual of Omaha, the people you can count on. The Miami Hurricanes, the underdog by two touchdowns, driving on their first possession, now have it first and 10, 23-yard line of Nebraska. Kosar with a quick drop. Guns the ball. Shakespeare's open. He's down to the 2-yard line. Kosar fire and strikes. 22 yards and a first and goal.
Don, he fired a strike to it. This is an alternate receiver. He's trying to go to the right side, the short side. He's got three receivers open on that side. Finally, he finds Stanley Shakespeare in a one-on-one situation with Neil Harris, throws it right in between the two defenders, down to the 1.5-yard line. I've heard how fine this man throws the ball. He's shown it early.
He has really shown it early, and now here They're down at the 2-yard line. First and goal, Miami. Looking for the first points of the game. Bentley runs and he didn't get there. The big front line of Nebraska, led by middle guard Mike Tranmer, number 64, threw him back. Osborne knew that Miami came out throwing, and they came out throwing strikes. Kosar with two big hits to Stanley Shakespeare. It's second and goal.
And it's good logic. You don't go up there and try and establish that you can't do something against a team like Nebraska. They know where their ace of spades is. It's in number 20. Let him get after it. He's had 6 weeks to prepare for this team, and he started fast.
Second down and goal, Miami. No score, first quarter. Bentley. A big play by Nebraska, Ken Graber.
Don, this is Mark Pressman and Howard Schnellenberger. Mark sends the plays in. This is his first year as a full-time assistant. He has his law degree. He was a graduate at the University of Minnesota. He works with the quarterbacks, and his statement about number 20 is that I've never seen a man with as much awareness as Bernie has. He's going to need it all right here, third and three.
Watch for the tight end to the right, Glenn Dennison. Kosar takes a look. He throws to Dennison. Touchdown, Miami. Glenn Dennison was indeed the man as he makes his 55th reception of this season. And Coach Schnellenberger and the Hurricanes have something to celebrate early in this game.
But you don't see Howard doing any celebrating. He knows it's a long 3-hour struggle. He's been in a lot of big games before. Don't let people think, fool you and get you the feeling that this is his first big game. He coached with Bear Bryant. He coached with Don Shula in a lot of championship games. He's been there before. This is the first time he's had the controls, however.
And right now, the place kicker comes out, Jeff Davis. Ready to try the point after. Glenn Dennison, who caught the touchdown pass. A new dad. Wife gave birth to a little boy last week. And right now, we're going to have a pause. Timeout on the field. 9 minutes and 18 seconds to play first quarter, and here's the touchdown throw again.
All right, you see Dennison, he's a 225-pound, 6'4" tight end that the people think can play professional football. Now, Kosar has helped him a lot throughout the year, but he's supposed to have very nifty feet. Real strong hands. When you get down in a situation like this, Kosar had a very small area in which to put the ball, but he did so.
Glenn Dennison, he graded up, trained up, John, from 212 pounds at the last game, November 12th, to 230 came in tonight. Teammates told him he was eating for two instead of his wife.
Yeah, but he didn't lose much speed, and that's why the coaches felt it was all right.
And here's the extra point by Jeff Davis. It's good. And so, the Miami Hurricanes get the ball for the first time and take it down the field on the right arm of freshman Bernie Kosar. Finally on the payoff, and it's Kosar to his tight end Glenn Dennison. Now with him, and he's just thrown 3 for 3 for 47 yards, culminating in the touchdown pitch to his tight end Dennison.
And when I asked Mark Trestman earlier, what were the determining factors in his picking the University of Miami, he said, some people say, hey, what were you looking for? A fine university? What do you like? Coach Schnellenberger? He said, I was looking for a top-line offense, and this was where I found it.
It's a pro-passing game. Bernie Kosar, thinking man's quarterback. He's a Dean's List student. Kicks it off a second time, and again he pumps it into the end zone, but here comes Rozier. What a great player, and Rozier comes from a yard deep out to the 31-yard line. And the Huskers take over for a second time, but down on the scoreboard, 7-0 to Miami with 9:09 to play in the first quarter. Turner Gill, the senior quarterback from Fort Worth, Texas. He's a great comeback story. 2 years ago at the Orange Bowl, he was on the sidelines with a brace on his right foot. The doctors told him there was a strong possibility he'd not walk properly again because of nerve damage. The operation, though, was a success, and they say the rest is history. Turner Gill's come back to be one of the great quarterbacks in the history of the Big Eight.
And I think Tom Osborne said it best as they attend to an injured Husker. He said, you know, for what we do, I think Turner Gill may be the best quarterback in this country. And his stats indicate that. I know they've got a good group, but he's the one that really coordinates it all. He's thrown 13 touchdowns, only four interceptions. A quarterback with a football team that scores 84 touchdowns, only throws four interceptions. That's all right.
It surely is, and Turner Gill will try to get the Huskers a rolling when we come back to the golden anniversary of the Orange Bowl. The Orange Bowl, luminescent on this golden anniversary night of the Orange Bowl game, the Goodyear Blimp Enterprise from Pompano Beach, Florida, high above the Orange Bowl in Miami. Both the pilot of the Blimp, Don Plaskonik, and his technical coordinator, Mickey Whitman, attended the University of Miami and played for the Hurricanes in the 60s. Right now, the Hurricanes on defense, the Huskers on offense, first and 10, pitch back Brogier. Winston Moss, number 92, and Joe Willie Namath is on the sideline after Moss made the stop.
And people might say, why is Joe Willie sitting over there on the Hurricane sideline? Well, in truth, the man that got him to Alabama was Howard Schnellenberger, and he invited him to come down and sit on the bench with the fellas, and Joe didn't take long to make a decision.
Joe ain't sitting. Nobody is. Second down and 10, Nebraska. Pitch back, Brogier. They get him there. Dillinger, not big at 5'9", 185, but he's a sticker, comes up to make a big hit. It's third and long.
Okay. You take a look. We mentioned over 90%. The Huskers throw on third and long. Now they've got their favorite play, a little option play from number 12 to Rozier. When it doesn't go anywhere, they're sitting in a throwing situation. That's what Miami's been trying to get.
Third down and 12. Turner Gill throws a strike to Rozier, but they get him short of the first down. As the white shirts come gang tackling again, led by Rod Bellinger, number 4. Rod's backup, Doug McFadden, was the young man helped off the field short time ago. But Bellinger makes consecutive big plays, and Nebraska has to punt the ball. They've punted the football this season less than any team in 38 years, not since the Nevada-Reno team of 1948. Has any team punted as few times as has Nebraska? 36 times in 12 games.
48. That was Marion Motley up there, wasn't it?
A high punt downfield. Livingston hitting the ball, and it might have rolled out. 33-yard punt by Scott Livingston. He wanted more. And up comes Kosar and the Hurricane offense for a second time. They went the distance the first time they had the ball, and Miami leads the game 7-0. Look at the Miami offense. Bernie Kosar, the freshman quarterback. Albert Bentley, they say that Rozier is the Rolls-Royce of runners, but Miami has its Bentley. Keith Griffin, Archie's little brother with that big run. Shakespeare with the two big receptions in that first touchdown drive. Eddie Brown is the deep threat, though. He's the guy to watch, number 40. And Dennison, who caught the touchdown ball.
I think he must have been the guy they've been watching.
Kosar sets Miami down at the 31-yard line. To the run, to Albert Bentley. And he's hit and hard at about the 32-yard line. Ken Graber, the middle guard, again making the stop for Nebraska. Coach Osborne in his 11th year as the head man. They say you can't follow the great ones. He did. Bob Devaney had 11 straight winning seasons and back-to-back national championships. When he retired, in came Osborne with great teams year after year. He's not yet gone the distance. This could be his year. Right now, Miami with the ball leads 7-0. Kosar's hit all three of his throws so far for 47 yards and a touchdown. Coverage is good by inside linebacker Mark Daum, number 51.
A little better than good, Donnie. He had a good 6-7 counts to throw that ball. Remember, Kosar's offensive line is excellent. They played 5 games without making a mental error, letting anybody get in Bernie's face. Now that gives him enough time. He's got plenty of confidence. He'll throw a lot of patterns where he has Dennison go down the field, cut back. Excellent coverage by Daum.
Michigan, an upset leader right now over Auburn University, the third-ranked team in the country, once beaten Auburn. at the Sugar Bowl in New Orleans. The offensive front of Miami is not big. Bertolucci is a freshman at left tackle. Juan Comandiero, Cuban-born, is the left guard. The center from Canada, Ian Sinclair, and he's good. The right guard has been a terrific player. I'll see even Wong, Alvin Ward from Chicago, and the right tackle is Dave Heffernan. Third down and nine for Kosar and the Miami Hurricanes. That's fast, Eddie Brown. And it's a first down, Miami. 12 yards and a first down.
Tell you what, Bernie Kosar is impressive, but that offensive line is more so. They gave him another six counts to throw the ball. Eddie Brown was not the intended receiver again. It was a man-to-man defense. Take a look. These five guys are setting up. They're getting a little help from their from a fullback, but nobody's even close to Kosar. When he comes over to Eddie Brown, he makes a fine catch. Burke falls down, and he gets a first.
A first it is, out to the 45-yard line. So Miami hits the big third down throw. Kosar throwing strikes right throughout the first quarter. Nebraska showing blitz. They do it a lot. They hold back, though. Kosar takes a look. Swings it out. Albert Bentley, head of steam across the 50 and down inside the Nebraska 45-yard line. Again, Mark Dom was on the defensive play for the Huskers, but going to be very close to a first down.
What a well-thrown ball. Good pattern. We look at the defense for Nebraska. They've got to tighten up a little.
They're giving up some yards right now. Big, strong people. Mike Keeler's had a big year for the Huskers, and Bill Weber, a small defensive end, but a good one. There's the key player, Mike Knox. He's broken five helmets already this year, and Mark Dom we've seen make a lot of plays. Knox, the number 44, actually on his sixth helmet. Equipment manager will attest to his ability. Second down and one. Long one. Whoa! Right up the gut. Alonzo Highsmith, the freshman from Miami, goes for 18 yards and yet another Miami Hurricane first down. He was one of the Florida Players of the Year last season at Columbus High School in Miami, but he was a defensive player.
And I tell you, the unknown quantity has an awful lot of quality, because these fellas are not in awe of what many people consider the best college football team that's ever been assembled. They had six people that made all Big Eight. They've got four All-Americans on their offense. Right now, Miami's running through their defense.
Miami getting big play after big play. 5:16 to play first quarter. Miami leading 7-0. Kosar against the blitz throws it, and he's high for Eddie Brown. It'll be second down and 10. Problem Nebraska's had in this great season has been giving up a lot of pass coverage, although there's good players back there. Dave Burke is one of the best, one of the corners. Brett Clark saved the Oklahoma State game with an interception in the end zone. McCashlin's the blitzer, the monster back. And Neil Harris saved the Oklahoma game with two plays in the end zone in the closing seconds.
Well, these fellas are sitting back there way ahead in most ball games. Now, everybody offensively is going to throw the ball at them. That's why they get a lot of yardage piled up, but not many points.
It's usually all a team has to do but throw the ball because they're so far down early to Nebraska. But not tonight. Miami's leading 7-0. Kosar. Oh. Dennison looking for a penalty call, but there is none. The coverage is real good. Strasburger was out of number 90. Nebraska. They're about 5,000 short in tickets, though. They needed it. 17,000 wanted to come.
You mentioned that Strasburg was on him. He was also on him for a very long time. Now, he's very lucky that he got away without a personal roughness penalty. We see Dennison, the tight end. We saw him catch a touchdown. He's trying to beat the two linebackers. They've got all the five short zones covered. Kosar can't find him.
And now Kosar has third and 10 against the blitz. They pick it up nicely. He throws, but he's not. And again, the Miami fans want a penalty call. Kosar is excellent against the blitz, even though he's a freshman. They work on the blitz every day in practice. Here it is. Knox is coming, 44, and Ward picks him up, runs him off the play. Alvin Ward with
the big pass block. When you see Knox coming, it means they have to find some way, as we mentioned earlier, to get to Kosar. You give a quarterback of his ability that much time to throw, and there's nothing he has to do but pick people up.
And now it is a 45-yard field goal attempt by Jeff Davis. He's hit only one of 10 outside the 40, even though he's a long kicker. This one's on the way, and this one is right on time. So Miami doing it all right. Coach Schnellenberger traps the sidelines again, as he always does after a score. 4:51 to play in the first quarter, and Miami has opened up a 10-0 lead. A long way to go, but the biggest upset of the year could be brewing in the Orange Bowl. 50 years later, here we are on the golden anniversary night with the underdog Miami Hurricanes leading top-ranked and unbeaten Nebraska 10-0 with 4:51 to play in the first quarter. Don Cricky with John Brody on a big night in Miami, Florida. The Hurricanes ready to kick it off for a third time in the first quarter. Davis hits a line drive. Here comes Irving Fryer. And he is struck down hard at about the 29-yard line. A 19-yard return by Irving Fryer, and out comes Turner Gill in the Nebraska offense. Interesting, John. Rozier had a 27-yard run his first carry, and there's the numbers. 18, and then they shut him down his last two tries. We will hear from him.
We'll hear from him, but they don't seem too concerned.
And 10, Nebraska. Shaleen, the fullback, running hard. Mark Shaleen takes it straight ahead from the 20 out to about the 26-yard line. Gain of 6.
Tony Fitzpatrick, number 62, the nose tackle on Trainowitz. Now look at this. It's necessary for him to make penetration in the middle of the line for the linebackers to be able to fill the holes and the whole defense to operate. That time he got blown off.
Rozier breaks open, and Mike Rozier is a hit for Nebraska first down. Rozier with that 41 pitch goes ahead for 12 yards. They say he's got a great throttle down move. He'll wait for his blocks fast as he is. Once those big linemen come in, Rozier makes his decision and goes. That time a 12-yard gain. Nebraska gets a first down out to its 47-yard line. 4:03 to play first quarter. And the clock runs. Miami 10, Nebraska nothing. Hits back Rozier.
String this play out. They keep all their people in good position so that when he does cut back, they've got some people to pick it up. This time, he never gets his play started. Jack Fernandez, a reserve linebacker who is playing quite a bit of late, makes a fine play.
Now, Turner Gill stops on second 11. He throws a strike, and the ball is caught downfield. Monty Engelbritson, the tight end, takes it inside the 40-yard line, a gain of 15 yards, and Nebraska has a first down. They don't throw to Monty often, as you see, says, when they do, I appreciate it.
Well, I'll tell you, one day they did throw it to him three times when they played Penn State on national television in the opening game. So in the rest 11, he only caught 4 balls. He's primarily a blocker and a fine one, but can catch it.
He's from Hastings, Nebraska, hometown of his coach, Tom Osborne. Now the Huskers starting to move and trailing 10-0. The give is to the first back through, Shaleen, the fullback. Big at 225 and very fast at 4.5 speed for the 40. He's ahead for 3.
Don, we talked about Tony Fitzpatrick, how important it is for him to get penetration. This time he throws Trainowitz away. When he does so, he gets some contact on the ball carry before he gets to the line. And look at number 54, Jay Brophy, sitting right there at the line of scrimmage to pick up the runner.
Second down and 8, Nebraska. Swing pass, Rozier. And a tremendous play by freshman Reggie Sutton. Rod Bellinger, number 4, comes up, makes the hit. And that's the third big hit by Bellinger at the line of scrimmage. That'll bring up third down now. They're going to spot the ball actually at about the 41-yard line.
Well, I've been told that Bellinger was an excellent hitter, but I didn't know he reacted as fast as he has. He's handled Rozier on two plays of that type, keeping him from making any yards at all. That's the way to play.
Tough down now for the Huskers, 3rd and 11. Turner Gill on the rollout. He's got the strong arm, and he lets it rip. It's intercepted. Jack Fernandez. Kevin Fagan put the rush on number 95, and Jack Fernandez, a 211-pound linebacker, comes down with an interception, and Miami has the ball again.
Don't have to weigh much down to get in the way of balls like he just did. Excellent reaction. Again, it's a 3rd down and 9. How many times have the Hurricanes put the Huskers in this position? When they do, they pretty well rest assured they're going to throw. They've got their linebackers in a deep zone coverage. Fernandez comes down with the intercept.
As we pointed out earlier, John, Turner Gill throws very few, less than 3% interceptions. Albert Bentley runs the ball, and Albert Bentley takes it to midfield, ripping off a gain of some 16 yards. The crowd is a Miami crowd predominantly, and they've got something to cheer tonight, at least this early.
Well, the important thing is that they knew that Miami had to get off to a fast start, and they did that with defensive outstanding plays. They stopped them. They made them throw the ball on 3rd down and longer than 6 yards to go. That is not what Nebraska likes to do, and when they did get it, they knew what to do with it.
Short of midfield. Bernie Kosar with a deep drop. Brown, he might go the distance. Look at that. Logan Eddie drives, hitting in. Touchdown, Miami, but there's a penalty marker down.
And he also did not get in, I do not believe. I think he was stopped about the 1-yard line. He stepped out of bounds, but I don't know if they saw that.
It's coming back.
But it's coming all the way back.
Shakespeare called for an illegal block.
Is tall, stands up, gets good vision, but hangs in there, takes his time, has as much poise as any quarterback I've seen in college, and he is only a freshman.
Even with the penalty, it was good for another Miami first down. On the 32, pitch back. Remarkable showing early in this game. The Miami Hurricanes, who waited for this chance, a rebuilding program the last 5 years, and they've played inspirational football since the opening kickoff. They've scored on their two earlier possessions. They wanted to kick off, and they did, to show they could stop Nebraska. Huskers drove and had a field goal blocked in Miami, and Kosar took over, driving down and going in for a touchdown and a throw. Kosar to tight end Dennison. Last possession, a 45-yard field goal. Now Miami has it 2nd and short. Kosar's looking. He's got a man open. Chris Kemp. Hit 2 now to his tight end, Glenn Dennison, in the end zone. Penalty marker's down. Extra point was through, but there's a penalty marker. And a It's against the Huskers, so the extra point goes. And the shot now is it with 1:08 left to play. It's a 17-0 Miami game.
Again, you can't say enough about the offensive line because everything is predicated upon how much time do I get to throw the ball. We have to be able to get our patterns run down the field. Dennison gets down the field. There's really nobody back there. It's a two-deep zone. Until he gets to the end zone, nobody makes contact.
Another look now from ground level as Bernie Kosar looking things over, and there's Dennison, a great sure-hand receiver from Joe Namath's hometown. Dennison's from Beaver Falls, Pennsylvania, and he's in for his second touchdown of the game. It is 17-0 Miami. The new dad, Glenn Dennison. For the first quarter for Miami. It's a rocket. Rozier, 5 yards deep. And the Huskers will get it on touchback at their 20.
The Cornhuskers are stunned, John.
Well, they've been stunned because I think it's been good defense by the Canes. They've stopped them and put them in their third down and 8 situation. Now, sure, Rozier's made 27 yards, 18 yards on occasions, but if he doesn't make the 6 and 7 yards consistently, they can shut him down, put him into third down situations, and make them punt.
Well, let's see. It's first and 10, Nebraska. Pitch back Rozier. Quick lineman again shed the blocks of those huge front liners for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Jay Bruffy shooting the gap and making the stop.
He's loving it. Tay got a little help that time too from old number 62. Fitzpatrick has been amazing. He's been out of action for 8 weeks. They did not know what to expect tonight. He said it won't be anything special, but it'll be the best I can do. And that's been pretty special.
It has been real good so far. The Miami defense has been the key to them getting the Cornhuskers stop and getting the ball and now an end around to Irving Fryer. He doesn't go anywhere, and he averages 14 yards a run through the season. Julio Cortez, one of those small ends at 205 pounds, stayed home and knocked him down. Remember, though, when it's Nebraska, they can start to score like a basketball team. Against Colorado, they were in a tight game. As one Colorado player said, it was like a bomb hit in the third quarter. Nebraska scored 48 points in the third quarter.
That's right, and Miami knows it. They know they're going to get all they can while it's going their way. They've got 3 quarters to play. They will not try and hold on. Don't worry about that. They know it's throw as much as you can at the wall and hope most of it sticks.
At the Orange Bowl in Miami, Don Crickey with John Brody. It has been a most unbelievable first quarter of play. The underdog Miami Hurricanes rolling up a 17-0 lead. They call this the most important game, John, in the history of the Miami University football team, and it could be the biggest upset in many years in college football.
I don't think there's any doubt that the University of Miami is not only excited, but college football is on a par with pro right now.
A big play. Ricky Simmons, a fleet wide receiver from Greenville, Texas, catches the ball and gets ahead for a Husker first down. When you look at the numbers, though, that Nebraska threw into the football computer this year, they about blew it apart. Over 600 points scored, 52 points a game. How many touchdowns you say, John?
84, that's not too bad. You can hardly even use numbers like that, but right now, they're not making much. And I'm crediting Miami.
Rozier going wide and another big play. Again, it is Julio Cortez, a junior from Miami, Florida. He's not big. Miami defensive coaches were talking about they'd have to blitz a lot against what they thought would be running plays to try to get these great Nebraska backs before they got started.
You know, they said that, but Tom Olivadotto said to me simply, we're going to try our four down linemen. We're going to try to play standard. And if that works, we're not going to do another thing all night. Well, it's working, and they haven't had to use the blitz. They've been in control of the line of scrimmage, and that's a rare thing indeed.
Early in the second quarter, underdog Miami leading top-ranked and unbeaten Nebraska 17-0. Swing pass, Irving Fryer, and he gets popped again. It's Dellinger.
book is Rob Dellinger.
Well, it's a tough thing to do, you know. We just got word that one of their outstanding linebackers, Ken Sisk, got a knee injury. That's why we saw Jack Fernandez in there in the last series of plays defensively, and he's done for the day. You know what those knees are like. I would like to mention that Nebraska has three of the top, considered the top four players in next year's draft. Fryer, Rozier, and Steinfeller, okay? And these fellas are handling them.
And they're much smaller. They say it was a 40-pound weight advantage, but it's probably more than that. The Huskers are even bigger than listed. Now, Turner Gill with a deep drop. Stands in, throws a strike downfield, but Kimball can't hold on. Scott Kimball, a very quick wide receiver, goes high up in the air. Irving Fryer also downfield, was off the hands of Kimball. Doug McFadden, a young freshman cornerback who was hurt earlier. Iced down ankle, so he'll probably not return, but pretty happy guy as they all are right now. 14:34 to play in the first half, and Nebraska has to punt the ball. Eddie Brown is the deep man, and he's tough. Livingston's first was only 33 yards. He gets off a tremendous punt, though. And fast, Eddie Brown goes to the 14. There he goes. He's tough to catch. Eddie Brown with one man to beat, and he cannot do it. Mark Shaleen, the blocking back on the punt, a 225-pound fullback, caught him. But Eddie Brown just ripped off his biggest return of this season. And Miami's ready to go again.
Well, how sweet it is. You talk about special teams doing their part of the job. These fellas up front have created holes. They've made fine plays rushing the punter. They've been doing their job on kickoff returns. Eddie Brown just brings a long punt return.
48 yards long, and it's down to the 43-yard of the 38-yard line of Nebraska. First and 10. Kosar, he'll check off a lot of the line of scrimmage. Knox blitzes. Swing pass out there, and Rob Stuckey had a play on the ball. So it'll be second down and 10 for Miami with 14:08 to play in the first half.
Mike Knox, number 44, the man we talked about as an outstanding inside linebacker. He's been instructed to get after the quarterback. We saw him try to do it with four down linemen. That didn't work. They're now sending five and six. Kosar sees the play is no good. He throws the ball over the intended receiver, and they go back to the huddle, second and 10. Most young quarterbacks can't do that.
Looks like he can do about anything Astor has all season. Bernie Kosar dropping again. Second and 10. This time it's intercepted. The monster back, Mike McCaslin, intercepts the ball for Nebraska.
Very important interception. The reason being, the Canes were on a roll. They know if they can get to 24, that's an awful long way to come back. Sure, there's a long time, but an interception at a critical time is very helpful. Mike McCashlin makes it, and Nebraska takes over first and 10.
Intercepted Bernie Kosar. There's Mike McCashlin on the sideline, but he knows there's work to be done for these Huskers, and they're a team that is able to do that. But right now, the Miami Hurricanes, a surprise 17-0 leader. First and 10 Huskers. Nebraska averages some 7.2 yards every time they've run the ball this season. But tonight, it hasn't been that way.
And first down has been the critical down. They have to do something on first down to keep the Canes from getting into an eight-man line at the line of scrimmage and stuffing them. They haven't been effective.
Only a two-yard gain on that play. Second and 8. Rozier, look at this man. Caught in the backfield and off he goes. Reggie Sutton is straight-armed and he's down but up.
I can understand why he went down. He got a good right cross to the jaw. It looks like Rozier may run it in. If it's anybody but Sutton chasing him, who's a real 4'6", 4'5", speedster, he's going to run away with nobody in pursuit. Sutton follows him all the way. Good. Well, they traded shots. Remember, in the last four games, Rozier has run for over 900 yards.
Right now, Turner Gill sprints out, pitches out to Mike Rozier. He's across midfield on a first down carry. It looks like he has nine before Rod Dellinger again knocked him down. Saw Rozier with that straight arm. Barry Switzer, the Oklahoma coach, said of Rozier, he plays mad every down.
Well, if he does, he sure is mad now.
Not what the Huskers expected. But still, 12:55 to play in the first half. A halftime score at the Sugar Bowl. Michigan in the process of a possible upset of third-ranked Auburn, leading 7-0.
No!
Turner Gill lets a home run ball fly. Scott Kimball is bumped off the play. So it'll be third down and just over a yard.
Well, they don't worry about that third and short. They're going to take two downs to have a go at it. You can bet on that. If they don't make any yards right now, this would be the time. Tom Osborne knows it's critical that they put something on the board, at least sustain a drive, and they will not be punting.
There's a big down, though. It's third and a long one. Shaleen hits, fights, gets straight ahead, and it's a first down.
McMurray, now he's coming in at the nose tackle position. He's holding his own also. When you hold that center right there on the line of scrimmage, you've done your job and your linebackers can come in pursuit.
Jeff Smith is in as the eye back now, the deep back. Rozier's out. This is Jeff Smith. Play faking it. Gill takes it himself. Turner Gill gets down to the Miami 39-yard line on a first down carry. He was good for a gain of about 7 yards. Free safety Eddie Williams knocked him down. Turner Gill has a lot of options. The Yankees want to sign him to a baseball contract. He's a top shortstop.
I think you'll go ahead and play professional football if somebody's smart enough to use him as a quarterback. You remember Wally Boone at Washington University about 6 years ago? Well, now he's coming back as Canada's best.
About a million per.
You got it.
Pitch back, running high with the ball is Rozier, and he's ahead for a Nebraska first down to the 35-yard line. The Cornhusker fans rolled on in, many of them early. It was a little rough out in Nebraska, as it has been throughout the Midwest. Rozier's run the ball now 11 times for 80 yards. Two big gainers in his first two carries of the night. And quiet lately. Guard again carries the ball, the fullback, the up back, taking it down to the 31-yard line. It's going to be second down about six.
Don, you hate to overdo one position, but number 62, Tony Fitzpatrick, stands the center up. That allows Jay Brophy, number 54, to find the hole. He hits the running back right at the point of attack. But even with good running, he picks up four.
You pointed out, John, though, Ken Sisk, Miami's leading tackler, went out with an injury. Right now, it's second down and five. Back. Rozier using his blocks in that great instinctive cutback move. He's down to the 25-yard line. Looks like he might have a Husker first down. Kenny Calhoun, the rover back from Miami, hit him, along with Danny Brown, the right end. Coach Osborne, in good times and bad, never changes his demeanor, a lot like Coach Landry.
No, but it's working inside. I asked him about, hey, you know, has anybody ever had a better offense than you fellas have in collegiate football? And he says, you know, I don't know. He said, points maybe, of course, all the statistics. He says, but you know, by game time, I figured out 48 ways it's impossible for us to win.
Well, he's got to do some figuring out to get back in this, but the Huskers are starting to move now with power football. Right now, with 10:32 to play in the first half, Miami wants to check things out. They've got a shaken-up player, Eddie Williams, their free safety, is holding a wrist. So with 10:32 to go in the first half of this golden anniversary of the Orange Bowl, the shocking early number stands, Miami 17, Nebraska nothing. The Huskers, Miami leading 17-0. Second quarter. maybe 4 yards on the play. Reggie Sutton, the freshman corner, knocked him down.
Don, what you have when you don't have a lot of blitzes, this is Jack Fernandez, the fellow that came in for Ken Sisk. Brophy was fooled a little bit, but Fernandez is so fast on the ball that he gets out in pursuit. Now remember, when the running back cuts back, and that's Irving Fryer, a certain number one draft choice, they've got five Hurricanes around him.
Fryer Sutton, he's out in the right flank. He's run the 40-yard sprint in under 4.3 at 200 pounds. Rozier doesn't get much, though. He tries to go behind a great right side. Lombardi and Outland Trophy winner Dean Steinkuhler and Scott Reardon, about 300 pounds of football player, but he only gets a yard.
And you can bet right now they have that old familiar option play. They are third down and 5. I doubt that you'll see them go for a field goal at this time. I think they'll take 2 downs and run it. We've seen them throw the ball in this position 3 times earlier tonight. They were not successful. You'll see some sort of runner.
Technicians in the world were that Dean Steinkuhler on a trick play goes into the end zone for Nebraska touchdown. Now we're going to see how it happens, because I don't know.
Well, I'll tell you what, it's one of those guards around. Every good team has one, but you never figure to throw it. Watch Turner Gill come out. Dean Steinkuhler, number 71. He hands it to old Dean. He didn't hold it. He left it right on the ground. The only way you can give it to a lineman is you got to fumble it. He cannot take it and hand it to him. So what he did is he got it from the center and left it on the ground. Everybody pulled. Everybody read their keys perfectly, and Steinkuhler slipped right into the end zone. That's a playground play that you never hardly see, but when you do, it's usually effective. I didn't expect a 275-pound offensive guard. You talk about flexibility. Watch it. Now the ball goes right on the ground. Right on the ground. Steinkuhler picks it up.
He just left it there.
You can't tell me that that's not a planned play, but he has to fumble it. He can't pick it up and leave it there.
They've even got a name for it, John. The Nebraska people say it's the fumble rooski, and it worked. Nebraska's on the board. And fan club again for ladies. Dean Steinkuhler. 17-7. And now, Nebraska kicks it off, and here comes Keith Griffin and the Huskers. Fired up by the fumble rooski, come down and cover the kickoff at the 15-yard line. Only a 9-yard return.
This is a very critical drive for the Canes, because Kosar last time had one intercepted. They mentioned coming into this ball game, we're going to fire it around the infield. Last time it stuck in the red jerseys. I doubt that you're going to see them try to run and control it, but it might be a good idea if they got the crowd settled down and themselves a little. Throw the safe stuff.
Bernie Kosar setting his team down. First and 10 at the 16-yard line of Miami. High back is Keith Griffin. Markers down all over as big Mike Keeler came blusting through and got a hold of Kosar.
And you know what happened? It's a too much timer, I believe. Maybe it's not, but I think it's too much time. And if it is, what happened is Nebraska shifted their defense late. Kosar has been effective in changing the play at the line of scrimmage to the proper call. That time they shifted late, fooled him, and he let the time run out. They have a 6-7 month season every year.
Yeah, they go to bowl games every year, year after year, decades in a row. They've gone to bowl games. This is the big one in 84, the national championship on the line in Miami. Leading 17-7, now is a first and 15. Albert Bentley breaks loose, but a penalty marker comes in at the line of scrimmage. Mark Dahm knocked him down for Nebraska, number 51. 8:41 to play in the first half.
Looks like they're running, going back again.
Run, call back. Bumbleruski might have done some long-range damage. Miami's taking the momentum away.
What it does, it starts with an interception generally or something. They had so many good things going for them. That was a great interception, by the way. It wasn't just another one. can turn the tide. At least old Mo do change.
Oh, he does change, and the holding call sets the ball back just outside the Miami 5-yard line. Miami misfiring now. Last three plays, penalty, and the one before that, you remember, was the Kosar interception. It's a live ball, and the nearest man to it was McCaslin, who you remember intercepted earlier.
He threw it away, but they fooled him again, Don. That's the critical thing, and that's what the concern of the offensive coaches was, that Nebraska has real good personnel, but they're also very cagey. They camouflage what they're going to do, and once you beat them for a while at one thing, they're not going to allow it to happen for the rest of the game. They've changed a lot of their philosophy right now. They're waiting until Kosar gets set. Then they're changing into what they're going to do, and it's bothered them.
So now, Miami pinned back, second down and 20.
Picks up just enough for a first.
Three receptions now for Dennison, the first two for touchdowns.
That was just as important.
Yes, sir. Got Miami out of the hole. First and 10, Hurricanes.
Number 16, when he sees Kosar looking to break free, he throws it off to Bentley. It's a loop-off pass. It looks like he's been taking lessons from Plunkett. That's called a bad ball drill. He's 6'5". Whenever they get a hold of you, just throw it any way you like.
And Albert Bentley was there to receive it, and it's another Miami first down. So they're out of the hole and out to their 41. Sound 75,000 here, and they've been rocking since the outset of this game. The call will be against the Miami Hurricanes. Turner Gill waiting for his chance again,
and he'll get one, he'll get several more. But the last drive was the first time they really did much once they did get the ball. Kosar's brought this group out from the 14 yard line. 10 for 17, 178 yards, two TDs. Not bad against the number one team in college football.
Bernie Kosar from Boardman, Ohio, getting some advice from Coach Snellenberger, and we'll come back to the Orange Bowl right after this.
Joe about Bernie Kosar. He mentioned simply, he said, this fella can throw. You notice he knows where his bread's buttered. He's in there with the defensive players. He's telling Tony Fitzpatrick how to play defense. He's learned a lot since he's been out of football.
And Joe Willie talks football. The Hurricanes listen. And right now it is a first and 15 play for Miami. Hurricanes a surprise leader 17-7 in the second quarter. Kosar looking long. Home run ball. Eddie Brown trying to run under it. Well, Bernie's got the long-distance delivery.
Well, I'll tell you, the important thing there is that he came back and he said, hey, they talked early. We're going to use the whole field. He's got a very strong arm, and the whole field means down the field as well as in the zones. And he has spread everyone out, which gives him an opportunity to hit Dennison in the middle on the third down situations. When you spread that defense out, they've got 53 yards of width to work with. He's got a real strong arm, and you can be effective.
Second and 15. He could be pumping it again.
Come on, D, let's go.
Rest again shows blitz, bringing the monster back up tight into a gap. Bernie Everybody's waiting for him to come early.
He's waiting quite a while.
Fellas have to get on the same page here with 6:58 to play in the first half.
I think you can look for them to now get up, call the play on the first sound, okay? They'll have a pre-planned play, but don't wait. Don't let them shift. They're getting the best of us when we do that. Not too bad for a team that's down by 10.
He's had 100 yards or more in his last 11 games. As Mike Rozier, the Heisman Trophy winner. Right now, the Nebraska offense waiting for a crack at it again, trailing 17-7 to Miami. Coming in as almost a two-touchdown underdog. Kosar, ready to let her rip. Second down and 20. Boy, they pick up the blitz well. He throws. It's low for Albert Bentley, and the Nebraska defense comes up with a big play. Mark Dom's been all over the field, 51.
Well, Mark Dom has a man-to-man assignment on Bentley and once in a while on Griffin, whoever's to the strong side working in combination with Dennison. And he's been on him for as long as you can expect a linebacker to cover a back, 4 and 5 seconds.
Dom is quite a remarkable story. Earlier this season, he had arthroscopic back surgery, and he also had surgery on his knee. All this season, here he is, playing a big game for the Huskers. Third down and 20 for Kosar and the Miami Hurricanes. Fast Eddie Brown goes up and then comes down with a great defensive play by Brett Clark.
Boy, you know, that's also a nice play by Eddie Brown, Don, because he went in that middle blind. He knew that that ball was going to be a collision. Brett Clark, who's playing free safety back there, let's take a look at it on the wide. Now, they're trying to get back to Kosar by rushing five people. They were ineffective with three, and they didn't get there with five. Kosar throws it down the field. Clark's playing the ball all the way. That is a collision. Number 40, Eddie Brown, and number 10, Brett Clark.
Great second look, as right now, Miami has to punt the ball, and Rick Tootin kicks it downfield and kicks it far, and here comes Irving Fryer. And Irving Fryer gets it out to the 36-yard line. 41-yard punt and an 8-yard return. They asked Irving Fryer the difference between Lincoln, Nebraska, and Miami this time of year. Irving says, at least in Miami, you can start your car. Other Heisman winners have been on display in the Orange Bowl over the years. Johnny Rogers led Nebraska to a national championship. Right now, Johnny Rogers out in San Diego, California. He was an Irving Fryer player. John Lujack, Heisman Trophy winner, never played in the Orange Bowl, but had some great years at Notre Dame, and now automobile dealer in Davenport, Iowa. And Mike Rozier, the 1983 Heisman Trophy winner. Gill, always cool under the fire, and he throws to Rozier. Mike Rozier showing his stuff. Downfield for 13 yards, and the Huskers are starting to cook.
Okay, when it gets wrong defensively, the linebackers can't get in the proper pursuit. You find Rozier in a one-on-one situation with Turner Gill. You've got to stop, make him pitch the ball quick. Now he gets on the cornerback fast, turns it inside. They finally get him, but not before he gets about 10.
And he's over 100 now, John. He has 103 yards for the night on 14 carries. Straight ahead, running the ball. Across the 50-yard line, Nebraska moves into the Miami end of the field on Mike Rozier's run.
Take a look at it. This is what a running back in the I formation sees. Now, he's got a lot of his own people crossing in front of him trying to get trap blocks. He cuts off a trap block that wasn't very effective. Fernandez stopped the play for all intents and purposes. Number 51 held him to 3.5.
Special NBC remote camera affixed to the upright in the end zone goalpost. First time ever. It'll give you some interesting looks as the game wears on. And right now, Mike Rozier takes a look at a Miami defense that stuffs him on a second and sixth play for no gain. Tony Fitzpatrick knocked him down. There's the camera. I don't know what happens to that expensive camera if one of those field goal or extra points hits it.
it counts if we hit it, I think.
Yeah, but the camera might be out.
Well, that's all right. The point's good.
That's the camera showing you can go up and down and
all around.
Small, interesting angles right over the field of play. Third down and six, Nebraska. Great throw by Turner Gill to Irving Fryer. And Fryer gets the ball down to the 25-yard line. One coach said when Irving Fryer lines up, it's like pointing a loaded gun at a defense. He can do it all. Gets it running. That's for 25 yards.
Yeah, I tell you, he can especially do it all when they don't have anybody in the zone to cover him. He's standing back there running a delay pattern. Now, there's one man you don't want loose in your secondary. That's number 27. There isn't anybody within 5 yards or 10 yards when he catches the ball. Gill had enough time to wait for him. They pick up a big first down to keep their drive alive.
Real big first down. Third down play, and it's now first down Huskers. They trail 17-7. Turner Gill stands in, throws to the end zone. Todd Crane dives at the ball but can't get there. Backup tight end from Trainer, Iowa, who's caught some touchdown balls, very fast for a tight end.
Well, Todd Frayne made a commitment a little early. It's a very tough ball to catch, a ball that's coming right over your head. But when he turned around, he turned all the way around rather than continue running. If you see him here, he's already committed. He would have run right under the ball on the dead run, but he committed too quick.
4:29 to play in the first half. 4:29 to play, Nebraska trailing 17-7. Pitchback, Rozier. He's a dancer until he's one-on-one. Then Mike Rozier is a knockout puncher. He hits you. You don't hit him.
Well, it's wonderful when a back can get his shoulders straightened up. He's a one-on-one situation. Take a look at the whole defense. They're a very pursuing defense, but they are cut off from the point of attack. Excellent block by the tight end. When the tight end gets that kind of a block, it keeps two people from getting into the pursuit. The running back can cut up and get some yards.
Good second look as we again go high above the Orange Bowl. Our producer tonight for NBC Sports, George Finkel. Our director, John Gonzalez. Our executive producer, Mike Weissman, is here. And he and his lovely Carol are celebrating a new 1984 son also. Adam, as are the Denisons, the tight end who's caught two touchdown passes for the Miami Hurricanes. As Turner Gill comes over to coach Tom Osborne. Osborne, as you know, John, you played with him briefly with the 49ers. You played there a long time, and he was with the team briefly. A very enterprising coach. He'll do surprising things in big games, and we saw that with that fumble Ruski.
I think he's a very consistent coach. I think he sits and he plans and he makes a real study of coaching football. He's done so when he was 21 years old. I don't think there was any doubt in anybody's mind. He wanted to be a college head football coach. And I think he worked under Bob Devaney, got excellent tutelage, and he's moved in 29 and 22 in a row. Isn't bad, is it?
And Turner Gill has proven himself a winner. He's quarterback 30 games for Nebraska. They've won 29. They only lost that controversial loss of sorts at Penn State in September of 1982. Coach Ellenberger, he's known the highs and the lows of coaching. Coached the Baltimore Colts. The owner came in the locker room one day and fired him.
Yeah, but to his credit, he was smart enough to walk away. I'll tell you what, he came back. He went back with the Dolphins and Don Shula, recouped, went back with the offense, got this job, and has really put something to work.
He's big in Miami. Pitchback. Here comes Rozier. Heading down inside the 10-yard line. And listen to those Husker fans that are ripped. They're down in that corner end zone. They put those Huskers on the 50-yard line, but they're down there making some noise.
They did give him a few seats. They gave him some seats down there where the Huskers are right now, about the 10-yard line. They've got Rozier coming right at you. I'd hate to be a defensive back knowing I had to handle him all by myself.
Again, they go to Rozier, and this time a gambling play is close to a touchdown.
They run that so much, that's their bread and butter. They don't feel that it is a high-risk play. When you have athletes like Turner Gill and Mike Rozier, the coordination is so excellent, they feel, hey, somebody doesn't stop it, we'll just run it in every play.
That's a confident QB that pitches out on his way down, and it almost resulted in a touchdown. Rod Bellinger saved it.
Also a good one.
A real good one. Now Coach Osborne's team ready to get right back in it. They're down 17-7. Second and goal. Penalty markers down. Three to play in the first half. At the end of the first quarter, it was Miami 17, favored Nebraska nothing. But now the Huskers are rolling. pounding back with that big front line into the game.
Well, you know, that's not really a very important penalty, but when you're sitting down on all fours in a defensive situation, number 62, Tony Fitzpatrick, they may have ruled that he jumped just a little too quick. He's trying to get off on the ball, trying to create some sort of a big play. I think the chance is worth the risk.
Big number from the Sugar Bowl in New Orleans, where Michigan leads third-rated Auburn 7-0. That came down the third quarter. And that is the scoreboard numbers here at the Orange Bowl on the golden anniversary night.
29 TDs for a season for Rozier. I get the feeling he may get one more right here.
He's the eye back, the deep back. Free ball. That looked like Gill held it himself.
He did.
That was a second and goal from just over a yard out.
Okay, good shot at it. We see that the defense beat the offense on their own snap count. The only way you keep a quarterback from getting in.
All season long, Miami's been so tough against the run, they've allowed less than 3 yards of rush to the opposition. And have allowed only 9.6 points a game to the opposition. Over the top, Turner Gill is in for a Cornhusker touchdown. And the big red from Lincoln now trails 17-13.
Well, they've done one fine job since that interception of getting back in this ball game. Not trying to do it all at once, Don, but methodically going back to what brought them here. Turner Gill, Mike Rozier, a steady defense. Remember, 84 touchdowns throughout a season to play. They've got a lot of time and a lot of weapons. And they're back in it with more than a half to play.
Starting to show that array of weapons as now the extra point by Livingston is up and good. And with 2:17 left to play in the first half, the Cornhuskers down 17-0 at the end of the first quarter are right back in it, trailing 17-14 as Turner Gill takes it in for the second Nebraska touchdown. The first, you'll recall, was a surprise score by guard Dean Steinkuhler. Another day at the office for Coach Osborne.
Yeah, I guess so. Again, that's on the outside.
Nebraska's got enough guys here. They brought in 136 players.
Yeah, but he only suited up 7 or 8 teams. So he may run a little short before the night's over.
End play drive, 64 yards. Over 4 minutes the time of possession. Turner Gill on the payoff end from a yard out. Reggie Sutton, a fleet freshman, is the deep man in the trio of receivers on the kickoff now for Miami. 2:17 to play in the first half. You know Kosar is going to try to get some more before halftime. At the goal line. Those Miami special teamers come out and throw some explosive blocks. So it went the last time with Turner Gill at rest for the moment. After scoring the second touchdown for the Huskers, they trail 17-14. Don Cricky with John Brody. The 50th Orange Bowl game.
We see another Hurricane coming off the field hurting a bit. There's a little over 2 minutes to go before the half, and it would be a very, very unfortunate time to create a turnover here. Now, they've had control of this ball game at 17-0 early in the game. With the kind of defense they've had, they expect it to be better than they are, but don't get greedy.
Here's a throw by Kosar downfield, and Shakespeare makes a great reception at the 46-yard line. Kid's got three balls down, every one of them a super catch.
Yes, sir. This is beyond this one. He's able to get both hands on this ball. His feet are off the ground. The ball takes him out of bounds. Steps right into it, Kosar does. Watch this. He hits the first thing, and he found a way to get his left foot in before his back hit out. Great play.
You put that left foot in, and Stanley Shakespeare gets a 24-yard gain for Miami out to the Hurricanes' 46-yard line. See his numbers. He was the key guy in that opening drive when Miami came down the field and scored.
They're coming after him. That might be a lateral.
Very nearly.
Well, maybe so nearly that it was. but it wasn't called. And I'll tell you what Kosar did very smartly right there. After he threw the ball, he knew it was close to a lateral, and he kept moving backwards. And the officials generally don't register right away. They check after a couple steps, and he got away with it.
The halftime show at the Orange Bowl is always a spectacular, and this year, Dan McNamara, the executive director of the Orange Bowl, and his staff have outdone themselves. A look back at some of the halftime shows over the previous 50 years. An extravaganza coming up at halftime. We have 1:54 to play in the first half. Kosar. Whoa! McCaslin had it and was running before he got the ball. Mike McCaslin very nearly with his second interception. They were going to Eddie Brown.
Well, that ball had to slip off his hand. I know it can get a little hot down there. He put a lot of heat on the ball, and it seemed to slip, just like a fastball would, and go over the catcher's head. If you take a close look at him here, you'll see that ball it's high all the way. The receiver never had a chance for it. I think it surprised McCaslin more than anything.
It would have been an unhappy surprise for Coach Snellenberger. A second interception. Right now it's third down and 10 for Miami. Again, they pick up the blitz. Here's a throw. Brown. Ball was right there, but he couldn't hold on. It's fourth down.
Namath said it earlier before the game. He's very impressed with number 20, Bernie Kosar. He said, you know, but I'd like to be 6'5" just for one game. He said he can see the whole field, and that was a perfect illustration of it. He had nobody in the middle, nobody on the left, got a little time, threw it out to the right, and the receiver drops a big one.
It was an open receiver and a well-thrown ball, but it's incomplete now. Rick Tootin ready to punt again. Irving Fryer's back, and is he something? But he's got a fair catch this one back at the 14-yard line. So the Huskers will have 1:31 to play in the second quarter after that 39-yard punt and no return. Nebraska, after trailing 17-0, now right back in the game. The unbeaten and top-ranked Cornhuskers trailing Miami 17-14. It's been something this first half.
Well, it's just been action-packed. It's like we didn't settle down for a quarter because neither did Miami. Settled down a little bit on the Cornhusker side in the second quarter. They've still got a minute and a half.
Nothing up the middle for Nebraska. Cornhuskers go to the run. It'll be second down and 10. And the clock runs down to 1:16 to play, and Nebraska not calling timeouts. The Fiesta Bowl on NBC today. Ohio State with a big effort beating Pittsburgh. Georgia upsetting previously unbeaten Texas in the Cotton Bowl at Dallas. A 10-9 victory for Vince Dooley and the Dogs. UCLA came out of flying and blasted Illinois, the fifth-ranked team, in the Rose Bowl here on NBC. Now Turner Gill, pump faking, throws to Shaleen on the screen. Like he was going to hit the wrong way.
Pretty good move on the stripe out there.
Big guy started to turn back, and Mark Shaleen went to Nebraska at Omaha to start his career. Didn't play football, dropped out for a year, got married, started lifting weights, gained about 50 pounds, and didn't lose any speed. And here he is, the starting fullback for the Huskers. Out of the 10-yard line of Miami, but could never get it away.
he'd have to be the longest, strongest gun in the world to get it down to the 10, but he did actually have a receiver down there. That's 70 yards past the line of scrimmage. That's a good long distance.
Ricky isn't big, but he can go. Shane Swanson comes out in the left flank now. Turner Gill with 5 seconds left, firing in the flat. Throws a strike. He's got Kimball coming out of the ball.
He's getting quite a bit of disagreement, I would imagine. I don't see a lot of complaints, Zoe.
The halftime show from the Orange Bowl, always a spectacular, and on the golden anniversary year, it's bigger and better. We'll also be going to Len Berman in New York, and we'll review the big plays of this first half, and there have been many. There have been throughout college football on Bowl Day, January 2nd this year. Here's the last play of the first half. Rozier picks it up, and Nebraska, after trailing 17-0, is probably quite content to only be down by 3 at halftime.
Very. They were outplayed in the first half. Two good drives in the last two possessions. Puts them back in the ball game. I think that penalty has been refused.
14. Miami in the lead as we come to halftime at the Orange Bowl. The interesting, John, to see the second half strategy if the Miami team comes out of that same wide open football that worked so well in the first quarter.
It'll be the same.
Halftime score, 17-14 Miami.
Hurricanes leading favorite Nebraska, 17-14. Don Crickey with John Brody here at the Orange Bowl. John, it's interesting that Nebraska has had a dominance in time of possession, even though they're behind, they've had the ball over 20 minutes. Is the Miami defense going to get tired?
Well, I think it does bring up the question. It's 20 minutes to 10 minutes in time of possession, and I think your defense has a much more strenuous time out there on the field than does the offense. It's a lot harder to rush the passer than block the man. It's an awful lot harder to chase a Mike Rozier than it is to be an offensive lineman and move around and do what you can. It's also an awful lot harder to play defense against a man running deep like an Irving Fryer. So when people say, hey, both teams are out there, it shouldn't affect either, also keep in mind the fact that Nebraska has three deep, very strong personnel. As far as Miami's concerned, they have 20 outstanding players, but boy, they could be tired.
Well, Nebraska brought 136 guys, so they're deep enough to go for two games. But right now, it's going to be interesting to see if the Nebraska Cornhuskers can stave off the Miami passing game, which opens so strong. There's been an interesting strategy change. Two Nebraska players are wearing the wrong jersey intentionally. That's really Dave Burke. Number two, McCashland, is on his jersey, but he's normally 33, Dave Burke. And Mike McCashland's wearing number 33.
Well, let me tell you why they did it, Don.
I'd like to hear it.
All right, because one of the keys for Miami when they started the ball game was the key number two. Dave McCashland is the type that gets up on the line of scrimmage. He's a fellow that moves around. He blitzes from his safety position. When he does so, it was a key for the type of pattern that Kosar wanted to throw. Well, early, he didn't seem to have any problem. Whatever he was watching worked. You notice it took him a little time, but he made some fine plays out of plays that looked covered. Then later in the second quarter, the jerseys have stayed the same. The funny thing is, I think Kosar might have picked it up because Burke has a mustache and McCashland doesn't. Now, they haven't gone so far as to change their appearance, so I'm going to imagine that Bernie Kosar picked it up.
Before the game, Fryer and Rozier changed their jerseys, but they switched back. Here's the kickoff to Miami. Reggie Sutton. With a penalty marker down, Reggie breaks her loose. It's a foot race, but it'll all come back. As two markers are down inside the Miami 20-yard line, a 32-yard return, but there may have been an illegal block on the part of the Hurricanes. Bernie Kosar with his quarterback coach, Mark Trestman. 178 yards throwing in the first half.
And that stat is a little bit misleading because those throws were for a lot of yardage, 178 yards in length, and that's a good stat. That's a good half by any standards.
We noticed this half that Miami didn't elect to kick off. Nebraska had the ball enough, they felt, in the second quarter. Miami's plan was to give it to Nebraska at the outset, though, and they did. Stopped the Huskers their first drive. Actually, a blocked field goal, and then Miami went right down and scored. Coach Schnellenberger wants an explanation. Coaches always do, and they always lose.
Well, I tell you, they don't always lose because they do get the attention of those officials, and somehow I think people who do kind of raise their voice on occasion when the ball goes against you get the best of it.
Hurricanes start off in the hole to start the third quarter. Kosar gives off to Keith Griffin. He fumbled the ball, and it might be it is Nebraska's ball. A great run by Keith Griffin, but Dave Burke, even though he's wearing McCashland's jersey, is the man who came up with a free ball. I wonder if the NCAA would look into that.
There's nothing in the rule book. We looked into it at halftime, Don, and we can't find anything that would preclude someone from doing this. We've been calling Burke McCashland the whole first half and vice versa, so you people at home, I hope you understand. Anyway, that was Burke who made the play. Griffin, who is an excellent one, but the Cornhuskers have the ball, and that's Rozier.
Boy, he takes a pop from Reggie Sutton. The Huskers go to the run, capitalizing on an early turnover here in the third quarter. Nebraska with a chance to take the lead if they can take it in. There is Dave Burke in the jersey of friend Mike McCashland.
They changed helmet numbers, too. I'm sure they didn't change helmets.
Maybe they changed identities. He's going to go the rest of his life being Randy Mike McCashin. Second down and 10.
Reverse. Nope.
Fake to Irving Fryer. A big play. Look at the breakup there down at the 11-yard line. We had two guys go to the moon for the ball. Rob Bellinger's only 5'9". Kimball, 6 feet. But they were both way over the rim.
When you take a look at the people who have made the outstanding plays for the Hurricanes, in the first half it was Rodney Bellinger. He made 4 big plays. He starts off the second half doing the same thing. Being one-on-one with Irving Fryer is no picnic. But he can handle it. Here you go. Got a piece of his arm and kept him from coming down with it.
Third down now. Nebraska needing a big play after getting the turnover. It goes out to Shaleen. Open field tackle, but the cut down is made short of a first down, so it brings up fourth down and Nebraska. But we'll see if they send out their field goal unit.
I think they're going to. You know, a lot of times you go for it on fourth, but there's 4 yards to go, and they have not been effective when Miami has given up to stop the run. And, well, they're going to have a go at a field goal and a tie.
Better than being behind 17-0 like Nebraska was at the end of the first quarter.
The last one didn't get airborne.
That's right. I mean, that's the reason they only tried 4 coming into this game all season. This one did. Right on range, and up and through it goes, and all of a sudden Nebraska comes out quickly, capitalizes on a fumble by Miami, and a field goal by Livingston ties the game at 17. The Huskers will kick it off again in a moment when we return to the Orange Bowl.
When your car starts acting up, it's really trying to tell you something. What it's saying is, take me to Goodyear. Goodyear Auto Service can add years to the life of your car because Goodyear knows your car from the ground up.
My Goodyear technicians can do everything from scheduled maintenance to most emergency repairs. And I've got this, the name you can trust for auto service.
Goodyear Tires and Auto Service for more Goodyears in your car.
Across America, 7-Eleven gives you the freedom to be an early bird, a night owl, freedom to give a reward for bravery, freedom to take a break, or to answer the call for help. 7-Eleven's business is based on freedom. So now we're a major sponsor of the 1984 U.S. Olympic team, giving great athletes the freedom to pursue their dream of becoming the best. 7-Eleven, the dream begins with freedom.
The 1971 Orange Bowl was the first of Bob Devaney's 3 consecutive wins of the now classic New Year's game, and the first of Nebraska's back-to-back national championships. The Cornhuskers edged LSU 17-12 with a fourth quarter score.
Right now, under Coach Osborne, it's Nebraska 17 and Miami 17. And even though the third quarter's only less than 2 minutes old, Livingston's ready to kick off for a second time. A high spinning kick. Albert Bentley running it back. Albert is a tough hombre, and he comes across the 20 to the 24-yard line. The 1984 Orange Bowl is brought to you by Nissan, who invites you to see the new 1984 Nissan 300ZX at your Datsun dealer now. By AT&T, the more you hear, the better we sound. By Owens Corning, makers of pink fiberglass attic blanket insulation. And by Xerox, managing information around the office and around the world. City of Light, Miami, Florida, on the golden anniversary night of the Orange Bowl. Right now, the home team, Miami, which really had this place rocking with its first quarter onslaught, is in a tie game, and Miami goes to the run on first down out to the 28-yard line. Reggie Sutton was shaken up a bit earlier. He's a gamer, though. He'll be back.
Well, they need him badly, and we mentioned that there is a possibility that defense could get a little tired. They can't afford an injury to a man as key as Sutton.
We see Howard and Mark Trestman, the offensive receiver coach, down there discussing how they're going to get something on the board.
Second down and eight. Kosar will be firing. He's got it. Got a man open, Eddie Brown. What a great catch out to the 47-yard line. Kosar throwing strikes again now with a 20-yard pitch, and Eddie Brown, who you'll remember lost one late in the first half right there, this time make sure.
Well, those are such difficult catches because you're making it in between two defenders, and take a look at it. Here comes Kosar. He throws, gets a little nudge, but when you're Eddie Brown, he knows he's going to get hit as soon as he catches the ball. We see Doug Burke hit him before he can get his feet on the ground. That's a tough way to hit.
Reggie Sutton with a bruised shoulder. Defensive player for Miami right now. Hurricane offense. First and 10 at their 47. Albert Bentley on a draw. Albert Bentley hit once and twice and three times, and he keeps on going ahead for an 8-yard gain.
This is the kind of play that they need more of. This rests the defense. It keeps their drive alive. And you take a kid like Bentley and also Griffin. These guys are hard running backs. Now, you can see they expect the Canes to throw. They're getting a six-man pass rush. Mike Knox gets shielded off the play. Bentley's not going down until he picks up eight.
Second down and two comes up for Miami. Pick up the blitz. Kosar lofts it out there and has his man Albert Bentley. Bentley's one of the spiritual leaders of this team. They love him. He was a walk-on, rode his bike to practice one day and asked for a tryout from Coach Snellenberger. Couldn't catch the ball at all his first 2 years. Now he's an excellent pass catcher. He's made himself one. We pause briefly for station identification. This is the NBC television network.
And this is South Florida 7 WSVN Miami Fort Lauderdale.
Drive alive.
Don Crickey with John Brody. Orange Bowl 84, Miami and Nebraska tied 17-17 early in the third quarter. Miami driving. They've not scored since the first quarter. The 230-pound freshman from Miami rips ahead for yet another Hurricane first down.
Take a look at Highsmith and what he sees. Once you get that ball and get those linemen spread out a little bit, real good blocking from Bentley, his fullback, allows him to get through the point of attack. When he does so, he picks up the first.
14-yard gain as Turner Gill waits passively on the bench.
This is what they need to do, Don. Miami has to keep the ball in their position for some period of time to let their defense rest.
Right now, the Hurricanes moving it through the Nebraska defense as they did in the first quarter. First and 10 to the run. Smith, the defensive player of the year in Florida last year, is a defensive player here at Columbus High School in Miami. Same high school that Don Shula's son quarterback last year, and they almost won the state championship or 2 years ago. And right now, John, the big guy on the sideline, says, keep it coming, and he sends a play in, and it looks like Kosar's looking to the end zone. Out flat pass he goes to Alonzo Highsmith. He's going to keep going to number 30 as long as it keeps working.
He did not throw to his backs much in the first half. He threw down the field three times to Shakespeare, a couple times to Eddie Brown. But his backs are renowned for their ability to catch passes coming out of the backfield. They're man-to-man on the linebackers. Kosar hits him right on the break. Nice to have backs that can both run the football and catch it. He's got three in Highsmith, Griffin, and Bentley.
You're in the backfield with NBC's remote goalpost camera looking on as Kosar now has been leading the Miami Hurricanes on a third quarter drive. You see his passing numbers. The all-time record for passes in an Orange Bowl was set by Namath in that 65 game. He threw 37 times. Kosar is probably going to go over 40 tonight. 9:55 to play, third quarter. Tie game. First down. Zone, man's open, and Shakespeare has the ball tipped away by Dave Burke.
And a flag is thrown, Don. That is in the critical area. Generally, it's offensive pass holding, but we'll wait and see.
Hurricanes down close. They started first and goal from the 9-yard line of Nebraska. And this new set of downs after the throw to Highsmith.
That was strict. That was just simply a motion penalty, and they refused it. I'm sure they would have taken a 10-yarder.
Fast Eddie Brown, number 40, at the top of your screen on the left flank. Shakespeare off to the right. Tight end Dennison, he's always a man they like to go to down close. Here's a throw. Penalty marker in the end zone against Nebraska. Coach Osborne says no, but the official says yes, it'll be first and goal down at the one. Dave Burke called for the foul.
We think it's Dave Burke. We haven't been able to see the look on his face. It's either he or McCashlin. We mentioned before they had switched jerseys. He tries to make the only play he can. He's got no help from inside by a linebacker. A close call. I couldn't tell from that view of whether or not he actually made contact before the ball hit. A very, very close call.
Osborne thought his guy was right there, but it's a first and goal again now for Miami. 1 yard line. Remember in the first quarter, the first touchdown on a similar play was a quick throw to the tight end Dennison, and Bernie Kosar, not wanting to miss a golden opportunity, calls a timeout. So this under control freshman comes over to talk to his coaching trust, and we'll be back to the Orange Bowl right after this. Finds itself locked up with favorite Nebraska, 17-0 at Miami. Point blank range. First and goal from the one after a pass interference call. Over the top. Alonzo Highsmith. Scott can play football.
Situation where they have so many outstanding freshmen, and Schnellenberger's done such a fine job of recruiting that he's using a few of them today, and that one just got the job done.
We're going to watch that again in a moment. You, that mounted remote camera. Right now, we're looking from the remote camera at the far end of the field, and here is Jeff Davis ready to try the point after, which he hits up and gets that carom shot. It's all right if it counts, and it does, so it's all working right. What do they talk about? The two things you can't coach, speed and luck.
And take a look from the back. You can see there's no one to meet him when he goes up, so he goes over.
Alonzo Highsmith into the air and into the end zone, and Miami has a 24-17 lead. Miami just went over the top from a yard out to get the go-ahead touchdown, as Miami, it has not scored since the first quarter, now has taken a 24-17 lead. It's the goalpost camera with a sweeping view of the sold-out Orange Bowl. It's been a tough ticket.
Well, it gives you a unique view, but when you get down close to the goal line, it gives you a very good view. You can see the hole.
Kick it off. Jeff Davis puts a boom into the ball. He's going to deliver it down to the 2 yards deep. Jeff Smith will bring it out. He knows what to do when he gets the ball. And Jeff Smith, the backup to Mike Rozier at I-back for Nebraska, takes it out to the 29-yard line. And now, Coach Osborne ready to send Turner Gill out with the play. Gill is a very quick-witted quarterback. They let him change up as much as he wants to, and Osborne says, very honestly, when we come down to a play that's a decision time with a timeout, we usually go with what Gill wants.
And he has six options run-wise, and he looks at the defense every time he comes up to the line of scrimmage, and when they run the ball, a lot of the percentage is audible.
And what if they're going to do it? Turner Gill calls his own number, and a big play is made by Miami. Jack Fernandez.
Fitzpatrick.
Boy, when a nose tackle can slide along the line of scrimmage, get enough penetration to grab the quarterback, that's beyond his job. He's played really superior football, Don, with an 8-week layoff. It's incredible.
That's one thing about bowl games a lot of people tend to forget. It's almost like a new season. Miami hasn't played in 8 weeks. It's like the opening game. Fire, quick pitch, and they go to Irving Fryer. He hadn't done a whole lot tonight, but look out. Some pro scouts have him rated the top player in the country, Irving Fryer.
Well, those are little bitty throws that often gain him lots of yardage. That time, Kenny Calhoun was standing right in his hair, and it only picked up 4 yards. That play is designed to go about 12. Let's see if they throw.
Fryer came in averaging 20 yards a catch, averaging just over 8 on 4 catches tonight. Gill on third down throws it short of a first down. Nebraska will have to punt. Did they really drop it? They did. They had that touchdown, and now the defensive stand by the Hurricanes has again ignited the Orange Bowl.
That's to the credit of Howard Schnellenberger, because when a coach can take a team who is desperately tired at the end of the half after having led 17-0, you get the feeling that, hey, the strength is coming back. We even questioned it ourselves. Since coming out in the second half, they have been strong.
You talked about momentum, John. It has certainly now swung back to Miami. Here's Eddie Brown fielding a punt on the run. And fine special teams play by the Huskers. A knockdown at the 27. A final score is now in from the Sugar Bowl in New Orleans. For that, let's go to Len Berman in New York.
Thank you, Don. Final seconds in the Sugar Bowl. Al Del Greco, 19-yard field goal. He makes it. Auburn squeaks by Michigan 9-7 without scoring a touchdown. We'll go back to the Orange Bowl, Don and John, right after these messages.
Back at the Orange Bowl, the news that just came in from the Sugar Bowl that third-ranked Auburn has defeated Michigan, but barely 9-7. So I think, Jan, we can safely say if Miami wins, they've got a better-than-good shot of going to the top.
Well, I don't think there's any doubt about that. That's a very conservative estimate. And if they do win, they deserve to be on top.
But to beat Nebraska, you've got to go to the final gun, and the Huskers really rip it open in the second half. Here's a home run ball. Eddie Brown is out there. He thought he was tripped, and the official now comes in with a late flag and says he was.
He had to make a decision as to whether he could catch the ball or not. It was definitely some sort of contact made about 20 yards down the field. It was a very late pattern. He was definitely beaten. Had he not touched him, and you'll see Eddie Brown going down, not quite able to get the ball. You'll see Burke standing around trying to get off the ground. He had taken a shot at Eddie and actually hit him. I think it's a good call.
Steve Danz, our NBC statistician, shows that Kosar's thrown the ball a lot, and he distributes it. Brown's caught 3, Dennison's caught 3, Shakespeare's caught 3, Albert Bentley's caught 3. This time they're going to run it. Albert Bentley gets the call. He's a tackle-breaking runner on first and 10. He gets across the 45-yard line of the Huskers and down to Nebraska's 42.
There have been several impressive Hurricanes tonight, Don, but I think number 16 stands right out amongst them. He's a big back, weighing 225 pounds. He's 6'3". He blocks well for Kosar for the pass and is an excellent receiver.
Boy, does he block. Hits that blitzer and makes him wish that he was back in Lincoln. It's another one. Here's a throw to Keith Griffin. And he's inside the 20 and down to the 17-yard line. Bentley just kills guys on the pass block.
Yes, he does. But you know what? It's really heads-up play by Bernie Kosar. This is the man he's supposed to be keying. He was wearing number 2. But here's McCaslin coming after Kosar. He sees him quickly. Bentley handles him, but he rolls to the right to make it a very easy block for Bentley. When he does so, he knows it's a blitz. He's got a one-on-one situation, finds a way to get the ball to Griffin. He picks up a long gainer and a first down. What was it that Schnellenberger said about Griffin? If he'd been playing at Nebraska, maybe he'd be a Heisman Trophy winner.
Well, his brother Archie was twice at Ohio State. Archie's here for the game. Gave the invocation before it. Here's Keith Griffin again. Somebody lost a hat, but Keith Griffin keeps on going inside the 15-yard line. Wade Priner, number 85 in the game, makes the stop for the Huskers.
Tom Osborne has reason to concern himself right now because he's getting beaten at the line of scrimmage. The offensive line for the Hurricanes are taking it to the Cornhuskers, and those two backs are running the ball.
They are running it with gusto and a big Nebraska defense. Now it's second down and six for Miami. Play whistle dead.
Too much time.
Yep.
And you know, it's funny, Mark Trestman said, what we do is, he is so bright, I only have to give him a very short signal before he picks it up and can relay the play. So we very seldom get caught for that. And too much time has been the result of the defense of Nebraska most of the time tonight.
You know, John, I thought you made an interesting observation. At halftime, we were talking among ourselves. You said that Kosar has fun playing football. And I think that's illustrated by his attitude towards the game. He said he wants to be a student first and foremost. He plans to be a lawyer. If he never plays after college, it wouldn't break his heart. He'd like to. But he always played football for fun. If it ever stopped being, he didn't want to play the game anymore.
Doesn't look like it's ever going to stop being either.
He's having fun right now. But here's a second and 10 play. They go to the draw. Keith Griffin working hard, puts two arms on the ball as those Nebraska Huskers, led by Mike Knox, the big inside linebacker, trying to strip it from him. You remember they did early in the third quarter.
That's right.
Couldn't score points. Or did score points. Scored the tying field goal.
Right.
And Miami came back and went with the head with a go-ahead touchdown.
It's a critical time. Now, Jeff Davis is the man that got him into this bowl with a last-second field goal against Florida State. To me, I don't think you'll see them throw a high-risk pass right now. They'll give Jeff a chance to kick a field goal if they can't find a back.
End zone look at Kosar. A strike. Eddie Brown dives down to the 7-yard line. It looks like he might have enough for a first down. A third and 10 play, and it appears that Miami got there.
We talked about earlier, their offensive line and backs didn't make a miscue for five games. Bentley, look at tonight. You think Bentley isn't geared into McCaslin? It doesn't matter what jersey number he's wearing. He better change again.
Eddie Brown makes the catch, but again, Bentley picks up the blitz to give Kosar time to deliver. Now the ball's down. First and goal from the Nebraska 7-yard line. 5 minutes left to play in the third quarter. Clock running. Miami in white. Almost a two-touchdown underdog coming in, leading Nebraska 24-17 with the national championship of college football on the line of this game. Across the 35-yard line, and a penalty marker comes in. We talked about the explosion of the Nebraska offense, which can detonate at any time. Right now, the Huskers had some catching up to do.
There, the explosions happened on the other side.
And now a Markoff against Nebraska.
Tony Fitzpatrick, 62, making sure the ref doesn't miss a beat.
Two very impressive Miami drives. The first was 75 yards for the go-ahead touchdown. The last 73 yards in six plays.
The way they've been executed is the impressive thing. They've changed the personnel in the key situations. They didn't go to number 16 in the first half much at all. This half they've come to him in critical third down situations. Also 40. They're doing it.
We were talking earlier, John, under Schnellenberger, Miami is rarely a loser on the home field. They're 11-2 on national TV under Howard, and even more impressive at the Orange Bowl. At 26 previous games, they've won 24 on the Schnellenberger era.
And people talk all over town. You see signs on buildings, and it's been the most enthusiastic Orange Bowl I've attended.
Unbelievable. This is your eighth. Kane Warren, they call it. And here comes Mike Rozier turning the corner. Puts his head down. He will take on the tacklers. Rod Bellinger back in. Makes the stop. A local disc jockey wrote a rock beat song called Hurricane Warning. It went right to the top of the charts here in Miami. But now it's doing the rest of the country.
I think most of the country can hear these fellas right now.
It is loud in Miami right now. Last five carries, Rozier has gained only 9 yards. He's a man who averaged almost 8 a carry all year long. Gill throws. Great catch. Scott Kimball had it and lost it. Scott Kimball from Camarillo, California, went up in air. He's an athlete, and a Miami player is shaken up. A penalty marker down. We might have a foul against the Hurricanes. It'll be a big break for the Cornhuskers.
That was a very late flag. It was not thrown while the ball was in the air. You do not see it right now.
This has been some football game, and it's got a long way to go. Kimball goes up, and they... rule that Rod Bellinger had a piece of him before the ball came in. Now that's all
you
coming
so?
Back.
I don't know what it is, but we'll wait and see. Rod Kimball's had a member of his family in the last 8 Orange Bowls. He had a brother that went to Oklahoma. Scott, excuse me. He's got a lot of brothers. They've been playing here.
They're going to mark it off from the line of scrimmage. Here's the call. It is against Miami.
Sportsmanlike conduct was swearing, because I didn't see any fisticuffs, I didn't see any action after the play, but there was an official there, and that can be penalized.
Sometimes in the heat of battle, the wrong thing is said, and if he hears it, well, like then, it's 15 yards. .414 to play in the third quarter. Rod Bellinger's helped off. Rozier had some thoughts before the game, and let's listen to Mike, the Heisman Trophy winner.
This is the real house of the Rozier family. As you notice, we have no breaking down boards on the windows, dogs running around, no shootouts, no gangs. It's a nice town, and I really love it there. I'm glad to be from Camden, Jersey.
Thank you, Mike. Mike reacting to a story that on another network, apparently, they shot some scenes of Camden in an area other than where the Rozier family lived. You can see where all the Rozier's grew up is a real nice place, and it's a terrific family. Met them all at the Heisman Trophy dinner when Mike got the award. His brother, Guy, is also on the team.
Sutton. We see him on the ground every once in a while, but when the play's on, he's live.
You know, and I think really it's time, if Nebraska's going to get back into this football game, that their offensive line takes over, because those are the fellas that have been given a lot of credit all year long. They're losing at the line of scrimmage to a very strong Miami defense.
And Miami, John, has throughout the season been stronger in the second half. Rozier, he's got blockers. Puts a move on, cuts back, and Sutton makes a move on him and knocks him down. Second and 15 play, got back about 10 or 11, but it looked like for a moment he might go the distance.
It also looks like he has a little limp on his left leg. Listen, when a man like Sutton is sitting in the open field with Mike Rozier, you're not supposed to bring him down. The fact that he stopped him, stumbled him, made him fall out of bounds is an excellent defensive play. Excuse me. That is Kenny Calhoun that missed him originally. Now watch Reggie Sutton come up. He's sitting here with about 7 yards either side.
Gill holding the ball. He breaks into open field. A first down and more as Gill comes inside the Miami 40-yard line and down to the 38. And they'll now check out the very valuable left ankle of Mike Rozier. An 11-yard gain on that carry by the Nebraska quarterback with 3 minutes left to play in the third quarter.
It's been remarkable that a man like Rozier stays as healthy as he does throughout the season, running the ball as much as he does.
Well, that is true.
Those great running backs are very durable.
5'10", 210 pounds, Mike Rozier. It's first and 10 now for the Huskers. Gill play fake it. Eludes the rush for a moment. Throws on the run, and he loses his man incomplete at the 25-yard line. A great play by Turner Gill. Threw a fastball on the run, had the ball right down, but Bonnie Engebretson, the tight end, couldn't hold on.
Well, you see, the Miami defense did a fine job on the play, but as Howard Schnellenberger said, he said, you know, this fellow, when he doesn't throw, averages 6-7 yards a carry when he goes back to throw and decides to run. He said he's only 8 when he does throw, so we don't really care what he does. It's going to be a tough night. They're doing it pretty well so far.
Second and 10, Nebraska. Huskers down by 14.
Trying to keep his group pepped up. They make a big play trying to get back in the ball game. 14 points down. Let's take a look. Dean Steinkuhler, number 71. He leads Turner Gill out. Gives him a little time to make the option throw. When he does so, it's a beautiful timing play. Fumble, which I don't think anybody expected, as Nebraska hasn't fumbled the ball all night. Very good tack play by Eddie Williams down there. The ball's coughed up, and an alert Miami defense falls on it. 35-yard run and the fumble.
Coming off the field is Fred Robinson, who came up with a football, a senior defensive end from Miami, Florida. Coach Schnellenberger doesn't have to go far to find good football players.
And he's played very well tonight, Fred Robinson has. He's one of the down linemen. He's recognized for his pass rush. Obviously, the Cornhuskers don't throw that much, so he hasn't been highlighted, but he's been very effective over there on the point of attack.
Now the Nebraska defense will dig in and try to get it back. Stopping a touchdown, but there's a big problem now for Kosar and the Miami Hurricanes. Downfield he goes. Whoa, very nearly intercepted by Nebraska. Dave Burke went up. And Eddie Brown turned defensive back when the ball came in.
Very, very good play by Eddie Brown. He's as good when he's trying to break up a pass as he is when he's trying to catch it. He knows he's out positioned by Burke on this occasion. All he can do is grab Burke's arms. As you see, he grabbed his left elbow, and when contact was made, he pulled him down and kept him from being able to intercept.
A very big play by Eddie Brown, but again, Miami goes now second and 10 from the Hurricanes' 1 yard line.
They better hurry.
7 seconds to get it off. Albert Bentley, he did well to get to the line of scrimmage. These Huskers are looking for the ball.
Actually, he couldn't lose too much. He's on the one-yard line already.
2:09 left to play, and the clock running, and the drama builds already today. Third-ranked and previously unbeaten Texas. So second-ranked Texas going at the outset of the day was upset by Georgia. Auburn, the third-ranked team, was a two-point winner over Michigan in the Sugar Bowl. And right now, Miami, ranked fourth in one poll and fifth in another, has a 14-point lead on top-ranked and unbeaten Nebraska late in the third quarter at the Orange Bowl. Bentley puts his head down, but Mark Dom is there to stuff it. That was a 3rd-and-10 play, and Miami has to punt the ball to the Huskers.
You know, I think they're using their head. What he does is on first down, he sees if we can't get a big play to get out of here. That's when I'll get some time to throw. But he's not taking any unnecessary, foolish risks by going back, throwing on 3rd-and-10, getting caught for a safety. That would really hurt him. I can't see where Bernie Kosar has done anything but act like a seasoned senior, and he's only in his first year.
Right now, his teammate Rick Tootin ready to punt from the end zone. Nebraska sets up coverage. Tootin unloads. Irving Fryer has it. White shirts hold their lanes on punt coverage and make Fryer take it up the gut, and he returned it 9 yards after a 41-yard punt. But Nebraska now comes out offensively with good field position. They almost took it in the last time, but then that fumble cost them the ball.
That's right. This is a little better than good here. Get the ball on the 36-yard line. This is a four-down offense.
Mike Rozier, the Heisman Trophy winner, not back in the game after he was tackled that one play and injured his left ankle. Trying to walk it off. Pitch back goes to Jeff Smith. He can go, and Jeff Smith is ahead for a 5-yard gain to the 31.
I think an interesting statistic here might be to bring up that Miami is the team that on first down has averaged 8.8. You get to see it on your screen. Nebraska, 3.6. That is not their style. And you must credit the Miami defensive down linemen and linebackers.
They've played very well indeed, giving away a lot of size. But when it comes to the quickness factor, Miami's up there among the national leaders. They give up less than 10 points a game. Turner Gill looks, fires, and he has a strike. Scott Kimball turning off the flank and out, goes down to the 21, a 9-yard gain. It's a Nebraska first down. That'll do it for the third quarter, John Brody. The gun sounds at the end of the third quarter. The score is Miami 31 and Nebraska 17. Could be a quarter away from the national championship. We'll be back after these messages from your local station. Mike Rozier, and this could be the key play as he was hit on his left ankle. You'll see him cut back. Reggie Sutton catches him, and Rozier, the premier runner in the game, has not been back since.
Yes, sir. It's a big situation. But let me tell you something. Opponents have scored only 10 points against Miami all season long. Now, that is an amazing statistic, and they've got a 14-point lead. So it's an uphill battle indeed whether they have Mike Rozier or not. And without him, it's really steep.
Up back, takes it straight ahead, Mark Schilling. Interesting, John, that in three Orange Bowls, Mike Rozier's never been in the end zone, never scored a touchdown this game. And in the second half tonight, after rushing for 138 yards in the first half, he had a total of minus 2 yards and 3 carries in the second half. Canes were looking for him.
I think what you're seeing right now is a little change in philosophy as far as Nebraska's concerned. They're throwing the ball more than they normally do.
Second and 9. Turner Gill takes a look. Man is open. Scott Kimball loses the ball at the end zone. Incomplete. Rod Dellinger with play after big play for Miami. And frustration builds on the Nebraska sideline.
Well, frustration should, because Turner Gill thought for sure he had a touchdown. He pulled the string on the throw just a little bit. When he did so, he had no play. You take a look, Scott Kimball's in perfect position. The ball didn't have quite enough zip on it, and Bellinger was right there.
Nebraska down 31-17, but a long way to go.
Saw years ago, he was like 45 or 50 pounds lighter than this. He was a walk-on, and are they glad to see him?
Well, they are from Lake Worth, Florida. 18. Right up the beach. Fagan's actually a sophomore, Kevin Fagan. Now, fourth down and Livingston ready to try a 47-yard field goal. He was on time with his last one. This one, it way short and wide left. And the Hurricanes take over. This 1984 Orange Bowl game is brought to you by Light Beer from Miller. Everything you've always wanted in a beer and less. By the people at Solaflex, wishing you a happy and healthy new year. By Emery, we've earned the trust of American business. And by Nissan, who invites you to see the new 1984 Nissan 300ZX at your Datsun dealer now. The numbers break down in Miami after a big first quarter. No points in the second, and again the big third quarter. Now at 13:34 in the ball game remaining. Hurricanes take over first and 10 after the missed Nebraska field goal. Quick hitter. Nebraska's there to stop it. Rob Stuckey makes the stop, and Mike Rozier, the great runner for the Cornhuskers who went out with an ankle injury, has not returned. Trying to walk off that ankle injury, was unable to. Jeff Smith has been in at the eye back when Nebraska's had the ball.
Can't do anything if you can't run. I mean, he's made a very big contribution. What's happening right now is that Miami is unexpectedly winning the battle at the line of scrimmage.
Even though they're smaller, they are indeed. Bertolucci, Commandiero, Sinclair, Ward, and Heffernan, the interior lineman for Miami. Kosar, play fake.
Screen.
Griffin catches the ball. And those Huskers are hitting tonight. A scoring recap of the game. You remember that first drive of the Hurricanes that passed to Dennison? It was 7-0. 45-yard field goal by Jeff Davis. Miami extended its lead to 10-0. Then another throw to Dennison from Bernie Kosar. It was a surprising 17-0 shocker. Then the surprise play by the Huskers. The 11-guard around. And Nebraska was on the board. And again on a 1-yard dive by Turner Gill, making it a 17-14 game. The third quarter field goal by Nebraska tied it. Then the Hurricanes opened up. Highsmith, the rookie, went over the top to put them in front 24-17. Albert Bentley went 7 yards for a touchdown. That's how it stands now, 31-17 Miami. Alonzo Highsmith had it and lost it. He stops the clock with the incomplete pass at 11:58, and the Huskers will get it back now as the Hurricanes have to punt. Kosar looks like he's been playing this in the big league for 10 years.
Well, I'm sure he has been going over it in his mind in the big leagues, and he'll be in them for quite a few more. You can tell some guys fit there. He's one of them.
He's got a long time to go at Miami, a freshman, actually a redshirt freshman. He's in his second year in school, but he was redshirted his freshman year. But as an athlete, he's a freshman. A line drive punt by Tootin. The Cornhuskers were able to recover it. Would have been tough to come back from a fumble by Irving Fryer, but a Nebraska teammate comes up with the ball. 47-yard punt, no return. Back after this. The shoe on Mike Rozier's left foot just came off. It's been diagnosed as a severely sprained left ankle. And you have to think at this point it's unlikely he'll be back. Where are they now? Leon Hart, one of two linemen ever to win the Heisman. Big Leon out in Birmingham. Hewitt, another Notre Damer, 1-64. Right now, Jeff Smith breaks it open for the Nebraska Cornhuskers. Gets out across the 30 to the close to the 35. John has taken his bonus money from the Jets and has parlayed it. Out in Tucson. Second down and about a foot now for Nebraska. Irving Fryer comes out in the right flank. He's not been hit deep yet. They're going to try it pretty soon, though.
But he's been hit a lot.
Oh, yeah. They're looking at deep now. Gill throws. They get the first down as they go to tight end Matty Ingebrigtsen. Taping up Mike Rozier again.
They're putting the try in anyway. You'd like to be able to go to your Heisman Trophy winner if when the game gets late and you're two touchdowns back, he could insert some sort of adrenaline, but I don't think it's their problem right now. Both of the backs that have replaced them, Jeff Smith and Paul Miles, they both run very well. It's at the line of scrimmage.
Miami is tough. The ball in the big 300-pound tackle. Mark Benning from Denton, Texas fell on it, but there's a loss on the play for the Huskers, and the clock runs down to 11 minutes to play.
Seems to be the way it's gone all night long. Just when something looks like it'll break, we flub a handoff. If we make a big run, somebody causes us to fumble. It hasn't gone their way, and a lot of that is because the Miami Hurricanes have played very opportunistic, aggressive defense.
Simmons goes to the sidelines. Miami was so prepared coming in. Rod Bellinger's taking some licks. Boy, he's passed him out. Right now he's helped off again. Lucius Delegal goes in to replace him, number 47. The freshman, Reggie Sutton, is up against Irving Fryer on the right flank. To Nebraska, first down out to the 49-yard line. A 15-yard gain on the play.
They've done very well at using very few seconds on the clock, moving the ball some 35 to 40 yards down the field in some minute or less than a minute. Their receivers have been able to get out of bounds after they've caught the ball. But remember, when Nebraska gets behind, they don't have a lot of drop back passes. They have that play action stuff that isn't really too effective when it's second and nine, third and ten, and everybody knows you're going to throw.
They go to the run. They go to the quick hitter to the fullback, Shalane. Mark Shalane gets across midfield down to the 47-yard line. On a first down carry, got about three. Jay Brophy made the tackle for Miami.
Well, you can't say enough for the defensive play of Jay Brophy, Tony Fitzpatrick, Fagan, you name it. All those fellas are standing people up at the line of scrimmage, and that's a great football team they're playing.
Good fake by Gill. Looks long. Guns it. The pass is complete downfield to the 36-yard line. Scott Kimble coming back at the ball.
Very well-thrown ball and a well-run pattern.
12 yards and a first down for the Huskers.
I don't think they have enough time to be fiddling around running into the line right now. I know that's their pattern, and they've always done so, and that's part of the reason I think they get in trouble when they get too far behind. Of course, they haven't done it all year long.
The catch-up offense has not been part of their repertoire.
That's right. I bet they don't practice it much.
But they have been in two tight games that have gone down to the final play in the end zone. The Oklahoma State game, they won 14-10, did Nebraska. And after that one, Tom Osborne said, at least they can't accuse us of running up the score in this one. And a couple of pass breakups against the Sooners of Oklahoma by cornerback Neil Harris saved that game. 28-21, Nebraska won. Jeff Smith breaks it open, and Jeff Smith rockets down to the 22-yard line. It is a first down and a 15-yard gain.
So much for my viewpoint. I start talking about how they have to throw it. Okay, take a look. Dean Steinkeeler, Raritan, the two real big, all Big Eight, all American, all everything linemen come out and do a fine job, give their running back a chance to run. Jeff Smith's doing the job when called upon.
Miami doesn't shy away from big teams. Notre Dame came in with a front line as big as Nebraska's, and Miami shut out the Fighting Irish here in the Orange Bowl 20-0 this year. First and 10, the run takes it down to the 20-yard line. You were talking, John, about the enthusiasm, really the emotion of this whole metropolitan area rides with the Hurricanes tonight. Miami football's been down until the Howard Schnellenberger era. He's brought it back, and tonight it could hit the pinnacle.
Yes, and so many people have talked. You know, when you take a look, here's a defense that's, you know, led the nation in so many categories, and yet they were given very little chance against what some people think is the best team that's ever played. So
Gill calls his own number. Quarterback draw. Three steps back in the quick shoot up the middle. He's down inside the 15-yard line. Coach Osborne sends in the plays. Got to be taking a look at that clock, which now is down to 8:35 and running.
They've used it very, very well. Remember, when a team picks up a first down, it automatically stops the clock until the chains are moved. So you can pick up some time that way. There's loads of time.
Third and two. Fumble. Tough to call signals. Very intense crowd. Looks like Turner Gill might have fallen on it, John. And if he did, he could have been enough for a first down. We'll see where they spot the ball.
He's got it. And it looks to be a first down.
Dr. Tom Osborne.
Well, I know this, that if they don't give it to him, I'd have it checked because it looks like it's close enough. It doesn't look like it is one, but it's within 6 or 8 inches.
Fourth down. Trophy winner Mike Rozier is out with an injured ankle. Nebraska without his best weapon. The pitch back to Jeff Smith. He turns the corner. He's got the first down, a from behind tackle drives him down to the 5-yard line of Miami. And now Nebraska goes first and goal from the Hurricane 5-7, 34 to play.
Tell you what, Dean Steinkuhler, you sit there and so many times people will say, well, why do we always feature him? He features him the whole scene. They run behind him a lot. He's a great blocker. He pulls very well, and he makes contact at the point of attack. In a critical situation, he picks up a big first down or is responsible for it.
It was a freshman, 255-pound Jerome Brown, 98, who made the knockdown. And now Miami player is attended to. Looks like it could be a heat cramp. They'll be back to the Orange Bowl right after this.
January 1st, responsibility for your leased Bell business phone switched from Bell to AT&T Information Systems. Ownership of the phones transferred to AT&T, together with most of the system's technicians and many service representatives.
The same people you trust are now at AT&T.
Call 1-800-247-7000. Remember this number for service or new business phones. AT&T Information Systems.
Nissan trucks are... The 1984 King Cab. Extra room in a compact truck is a Nissan innovation. 9 cubic feet of lockable space behind the seats.
Sometimes it hauls my work, and sometimes it hauls my workers.
The one and only King Cab, a tough Nissan Arid.
Turner Gill turns up, turns in, gets down to the one. To play the clock running. Nebraska, after scoring early in the third quarter after fumbling a Miami, recovering a Miami fumble to tie the game, has not scored since. As you see, the Hurricane defense holding Nebraska to 35 points below its season average. Huskers come in scoring like a basketball team. 52 points a game. Over the top, Jeff Smith is in for a touchdown. 6:55 to play, and the Huskers are right back in it.
I don't think there's much doubt they'll go for the one-pointer here. Some people say, hey, wait a minute, what do we do? Do we go for the two-pointer or the one-pointer? I think psychologically it would be a defeat if you go for a two-pointer and don't make it. You see, they're starting to move off at the line, at the point of attack. Their offensive line actually had all the action on the other side of the goal line. I think it would be a downer if they went for two and didn't make it right here, whereas if they kick the point, they stay within seven and a chance to make two later. And without Mike Rozier.
Saw Johnny Rogers on the sideline. They were asking, where is he? He's right here. There is no overtime, as you know, in college football. The extra point by Livingston is up and good, and it's now a 31-24 game. Nebraska will kick off with 6:55 to play. 31-24 Miami with a 7-point lead now as Nebraska puts up its first touchdown of the second half on an over-the-top dive by tailback Jeff Smith. An interesting dilemma now facing Nebraska. If they should tie this game, would they get the next touchdown? Would they go for the tie and maybe get the national championship? They could conclude unbeaten.
I think they definitely would if they did it soon enough, but I think if it happened late in the ball game, they'd go for the win, and I think we'd have a chance to see whether Tom Osborne thought it was better to win the national championship or to win the Orange Bowl. I know it would be a very unpopular decision if it happened late and they didn't take a shot to win it, but those are coaching decisions.
I can remember a game several years ago where there was a 10-10 tie between a couple of nationally ranked teams, and it didn't settle well with the fans at all in Notre Dame, did it?
People forget, though, Michigan State punted after Notre Dame did.
Yeah, that man seemed to survive quite well.
A high-spinning kick down to Keith Griffin. He's got a problem. Look at those Huskers come down. Boy, these guys are playing like champions now. 6:49 to play. Miami has the ball. John, of course, a moment ago referring to the 1966 game between the two unbeatens, Notre Dame and Michigan State. Ended in a 10-10 tie, and the Irish won the national championship.
And it was for the same reason that they went for the tie. So, you know, if people make such a large issue of who wins the national championship, and people have done so, which is most important?
It's a pretty large issue, Rhodes.
That's right.
The whole state of Nebraska rallies around the big red, and right now they're putting the heat on Kosar.
I think Bernie Kosar would like to have access to what this camera does. He'd like to see number 87 coming around, you know, Bill Weber hitting him in the back just as he lets go of the ball. It'd be a whole lot easier to play that position if you could.
That was the NBC remote camera up on the goalpost. Eddie Brown with his fifth reception. He got Miami out of jail for the moment. It's second down and four right now. Miami leading 31-24 with 6:41 to play. Keith Griffin puts his head down and Big Rob Stuckey knocks him down. It's 61 degrees in Miami.
A lot warmer on the field underneath those shoulder pads and helmets.
Light it up, signaling the new year.
That's a little mock-up of a man that's injured. I guess all's fair and whatever, not by me. Let's see what Bernie Kosar does here. I think there's a good chance you'll see him throw a pass in the 3rd and 2 right here. Little short one.
Nebraska blitzing. Bernie throws. He's got Keith Griffin. He's got a first down. And Brett Clark knocked him down, but the money throw from freshman Bernie Kosar to senior Keith Griffin gets a first down for Miami, and you see the clock 5:51 to play.
I tell you, we had Keith Griffin so far open, he threw that thing like a shot put. That baby was not going to get anywhere but to old Keith. Good play at a critical time. Good call.
Old Keith is all business, too, isn't he, when he gets it? That earlier fumble, he's made some big, big plays all night long for Miami. Got away from the Buckeyes, did Keith Griffin. Up Columbus to come to Miami. 1st and 10, Hurricanes. Keith Griffin, he's popped by Mike Knox, that tough inside linebacker who broke 5 helmets already this season.
How'd he break them? While they were on his head, or?
Yes, he did. Yes.
He didn't drop them after practice.
All right, Mike Knox, outstanding linebacker.
So he broke him.
Gets in good position.
6'3", 235, Mike Knox from Castle Rock, Colorado. Butkus type. See, they don't like to be around him in practice. He didn't know when it's the real thing or not. He knows, but he likes to go full speed all times. Knox, 2nd down and 9 now, Miami. Hurricanes lead by 7. 4:40 to play. In the flat, it goes to Eddie Brown, and he dives ahead. Breaks it open. Look at this play. That's just fabulous athletic ability. 41 yards.
There are a lot of people with great athletic ability, Don, but there aren't many people that continually come up with the needed play at the needed time. Kosar's one, and number 40, Eddie Brown. He's the fellow that got them back in the ball game against Florida State, gave him a chance to kick a field goal late, win the ball game. Beautiful play, breaking those two tackles.
Boy, it was a tremendous play. 31-24, Miami and White with the lead. Gosar has set an Orange Bowl record for passing yardage, 300 yards for the freshman. Live action, Albert Bentley. He's been quiet for a while, but not now.
Oh! That was a touchdown. If he keeps his feet, he made so many good moves to get in the open. It was very difficult to keep his balance, but what a great play. There's another man, number 16. Their offensive personnel has really outplayed Nebraska's tonight. Number 20, 16, 44, 40, you name them. Number 6, Stanley Shakespeare, early in the ballgame. All of their what you call skilled positions have had great nights.
Albert Bentley with the big run. As you point out, Jen, he was gone and to be able to hold his footing. He did get up first down. Some party in Miami.
Well, you know, it's funny. No matter how
the
much you hear...
The old bros will be up late.
No matter how much you hear and how much enthusiasm the city of Miami had, all the smart people said, hey, yeah, but they're playing against Nebraska. Now, who did they beat? They beat some good teams. I'll tell you, East Carolina and Florida State at the end of the year were playing exceptional football. Anybody that saw them play in a bowl game knows. And these guys have come to play.
Pick it up, Keith Griffin. Go to the draw play, and Keith Griffin is ahead on a first down carry down to the 26-yard line.
You know, by design, when you're blitzing against a draw play, you should stop it for a loss. But if just a small crack opens and the offensive linemen use good technique, they can break something for the back, and he can pick up good yardage. That's what happened. Kosar read the blitz, gave the linemen a chance to see their blocks, and look at the crack they created. Beautiful play. Bentley, number 16, was in there at the point of attack.
Juan Comandiero, the Cuban-born guard, had the big seal block to open the draw. It's second down and a long four. Keith Griffin runs, and the Cornhuskers, Rob Stuckey, rides him down. But importantly now, the clock continues to tick. Working against the top-ranked and unbeaten Cornhuskers, who at the moment trail Miami 31-24.
And if they get one more timeout, it's going to force Nebraska to take their timeouts before they get possession of the ball. This is a very big play. Now, if they can move the ball about 3 yards, they'll be able to kick a 40-yard field goal, and this ball game would be history. So I expect them to probably either throw a short out or try to run the ball about 3 yards.
It's third down and a long three. Keith Griffin, nothing there, and the Cornhuskers shut it down. It brings up fourth down. And the game clock continues to tick. 153, 52. Now they stop it. One of Coach Schnellenberger's sons. Another one's on the team. Stu Schnellenberger, important part of it. 1:53 to go in Miami's quest for a national championship. Not New Year's night in Miami, but the celebration's bigger than any New Year's, as right now the Hurricanes, an underdog, are leading top-ranked and unbeaten Nebraska 31-24. Bernie Kosar's right arm has been a key, the freshman from Boardman, Ohio. And another very, very difficult factor that's mitigated against the Cornhuskers is the injury to their great runner, Mike Rozier, the Heisman Trophy winner, out with an injured ankle. Went out in the second half. Fourth down now. Here's the field goal attempt. Jeff Smith drills it. Didn't get there. Nebraska will get the ball with 1:47 to play. John, we're going down to the final gun, it looks like, in this one.
And you can see some coaches are very quiet and passive. Others get their group ready. And this man has been an inspirational force for this group all year long. He's not about to take a back seat right now. 1 minute and 47 seconds between the Miami Hurricanes and a national championship.
Wide left, and it's no good. And so the Cornhuskers get back the ball with 1:47 to go. And the unbeaten Nebraska team trailing by 7. Bellinger saved a touchdown. Finally, Fryer, who's been dormant, explodes for 29 yards, very nearly exploding for the distance.
What a beautiful throw. Now that was a play in which he only took 3 steps back, It's the first pass in this half on first down. And that is a very effective decision itself.
29 yards, it used 6 seconds. It's covering some ground.
A lot of timeouts left, a lot of time. There's no hurry either way, but I think this man has left it all out there. Rodney Bellinger, number four, has done a phenomenal job on Irving Fryer. Played him one-on-one throughout most of the evening. Stopped a lot of in sweeps. Let's take a look here. Just a little three-step drop. He catches Fryer in between the zone, and we're back on the field.
Live action, first and 10. Gill gets it away on the run. Shane Swanson goes up in the air, but came down empty. Overthrow, it's Lee, second down and 10. And the game clock shows 1:28 to play.
Jack Fernandez made another good play, forcing Turner Gill to throw the ball a little before he won it.
Nebraska, unbeaten, the dominant team in college football this year with a 52-point-a-game scoring average, trying to come back without the Heisman Trophy winner, Mike Rozier, sideline with an injured ankle. That's the amount of time remaining in the game. Here's a throw. It's a good catch, and the Huskers have it down to the 26-yard line of Miami, a 19-yard gain.
Beautiful pattern. That was perfectly timed and a beautiful pattern. They can throw that ball from a drop back, and people have talked about for what Nebraska does. Turner Gill is a great quarterback. I think he could be an exceptional T-formation pro-style quarterback. It's just that he can adapt to any style.
Ricky Simmons. Wide now, and here's a give up the middle, and this time the Hurricanes defense is there to shut down Jeff Smith as the clock runs. 1:13 to go. And now Nebraska signals for and is allotted a timeout. And then, of course, theoretically, looking at a possible Nebraska score, John, if they go in, they have the option of going for the win with a two-point conversion. The much higher percentage kicked extra point would mean a tie game. They'd still finish the season unbeaten, and would they be crowned now? In all the probability, they would be. But we don't know. We don't vote.
You know, that's a decision for Tom Osborne to make. It's obvious if he goes for a two-pointer, the only way he can come out on top is go for a two-pointer and make it, because then there can't be any second-guessing. A two-pointer and miss, they say, hey, why don't you go for the national championship? A one-pointer and tie, why don't you go for the win? So he's in a no-win situation if they pick up the next 25 yards. But, hey, that's no gimme. They're playing against the toughest team in the country in the last quarter of football. This group's only given up 10 points all year long.
Tom Osborne, a doctor of educational psychology, Ph.D., he can stay under control, and so can Coach Snellenberger. Second down and 8. 1:12 to play. Turner Gill with a 28 pass. Irving Fryer, he dropped the ball. Best receiver in the country, but even the great ones have a lapse. And well, Fryer's came at a most inopportune time.
Irving Fryer has not been a big factor tonight. He's got a chance, as the great ones always do, to make the catch to put them back in the ball game, and he dropped a gimme.
Steinkohler picks it up to see if it's a fumble. In motion, were they not, John?
Well, it's pretty tough to tell. We can
a play they'll never forget if Nebraska doesn't go in.
Now, I don't know if this man has ever dropped a ball, and they've never been in this kind of situation before, but to be regarded as one of the top five players in college football, you couldn't have ever dropped a ball in a situation like that. And I don't think there's any more to say, because nobody could feel worse. He's just hoping to get another chance.
That's it. And now it could be his very last one, because the Cornhuskers have fourth down coming up. Fourth down and 8. The ball at the 24-yard line of Miami. One last look. The earlier play, Irving Fryer with the goal line sprint up perfectly thrown ball from Gill, but it's dropped. He split the defenders and was wide open, was Irving Fryer. Then in his heartbreak, he collapses to the ground. And now, fourth down is coming up for Nebraska. The Cornhuskers with the longest winning streak in major college football. They've won 22 straight games. 12-0 this season. Ranked number one all year. But they're down by seven. Executed play by Turner Gill, 24 yards and a touchdown. Now it's a 31-30 game. And what does Nebraska do?
I have not seen the kicker come on the field, and I don't think he's coming on the field. And I might as well, I think that they've got things going their way. Tom Osborne made this decision a long time ago. Don't think that this situation caught him by surprise. He's decided to go for two and take his shot and win, and I commend him for it.
This is for the national championship for Nebraska. Incomplete. To be given great credit for trying.
And let's remember, this ball game is not over.
Right you are. 48 seconds left to play.
But this is the try. I think he made the right call. I just commend a guy that has the nerve to do that. He's willing to put it out there on the line. He called a good play. The ball was dropped. That's the way football goes. Miami's played a great football game. And if in 48 seconds they become the winner, they certainly deserve to be national champions.
The golden anniversary of the Orange Bowl turns out to be the greatest game of all.
And an onside kick, I don't think we have to make much discussion about. It will happen. Let's see how it comes out.
Coach Howard Schnellenberger. Heartbeat's got to be 180.
He knows this case is not closed. Mark Trestman is down there saying, look, coach, if we recover the ball, we do not have to run a play to run out the clock. They've got two timeouts. That won't be enough. We'll be able to end this thing and go in a winner. But they must get the onside kick. I thought they had some timeouts, and they don't.
What a football game in the golden anniversary year. Steve Lynch, the Orange Bowl president. All the people on the Orange Bowl committee had hoped for a great game. There was speculation Miami would be blown out. Everybody here had faith in Tom Osborne. Showed his dignity and his courage, going for the win. The Huskers didn't get it, though. And now Miami has only to run out the clock.
And, you know, just like ball games go, and certain people are the last one's always the most important.
You know, when you're in this business, John, you always get asked, what's the greatest game you ever were at or saw? This is it for me.
And this is about as fine a football game as ever been played, and happens to be for the national championship. That man has done it all.
Set it to music. This is Hurricane 1. morning. Number one in Miami.
They say the wind is picking up. I heard it just this morning. The flags are being raised because it's a full-blown hurricane warning.
They're lining in formation, all shining orange and green. Busting butt on their own turf. There's nothing they ain't seen.
You just look out, Nebraska. Better hold on to your corn. Because the hurricane is coming. It's looking like a storm.
Block them.
You can do it now.
Knock them.
To the ground.
Drag them to their end zone and kick their butts around. Hit them.
Where the corn don't grow.
Plant them.
In the ground.
Make sure they hear the warning that the hurricane's in town.
Watch out for the hurricane that's stirring up the night. When they go move, you better make it right. Watch out for the hurricane that's going up the storm.
So much for hurricane warning, and now the final 46 seconds of this game. Game that'll be replayed emotionally by these players and their fans throughout the years. A hallmark game in college football. A great demonstration of courage by Nebraska going for the win. And for Miami, an absolutely miracle year. The dream season as they come back from a bad loss opening day to go to 11 straight wins, and in all probability when the votes are in, a first ever national championship for the Hurricanes.
I'd like to say that the coaching staff, the players themselves, they were going to win tonight. They were not in awe of Nebraska. Now, many of the fans were, most of the writers were. I think anybody who had seen Nebraska play was. But these guys did it because they knew they could.
I'll tell you, right now, school's out. This place up for grabs. Says they're going to be the best team we'll face all year, but they can be beaten. We can't make mistakes if we're going to do it, but we can win. And they did.
And it was an offense that came out from the gun, throwing the ball around. They knew they had to put some points on the board early, get a lead, hang in there. They did that. Then comes Nebraska back, and they did it again. I mean, when everybody said, oh, boy, they'll make it close anyway, now they open up another 14-point lead. That man right there, Dennison, catches two touchdowns.
And here is the critical play of the game. Nebraska goes for two. The play is broken up at the goal line, and the Huskers, in their valiant effort to win the game rather than go for the tie, come up empty. And ultimately now, the victory and possibly, quite more than possibly, the national championship going to the University of Miami. There are two polls, of course, the coaches' poll and the writers' poll. We'll be back to the 50th Orange Bowl in a moment. But right now, with Miami a 31-30 victor, let's go to Len Berman in New York. Len?
Bowl games in history, perhaps the top Orange Bowl in their 50-year history. Miami knocks off powerful Nebraska as Howard Schnellenberger and company do it. They took a 17-0 lead. Bernie Kosar, 2-yard touchdown pass to Glenn Dennison. That was the first of the touchdown plays. Then the trick play. Here's how Nebraska got on the board. The snap that they fumbled on purpose, the guard Dean Steinkuhler picked it up, ran 19 yards for the touchdown, and Nebraska finally scored and trailed 17-7. Now second half action. Albert Bentley, 7 yards away, he takes it in. Miami now leads it 31-17. Critical play here, Mike Regier is hurt. Leaves the game with an ankle injury. He finished with 147 yards. But Nebraska came back. Heartbreak here for Irving Fryer. Wide open, and he dropped it. But Nebraska got Fryer off the hook. Jeff Smith did it on a 4th and 8. Smith takes it all the way in for the touchdown, and Nebraska closes to within 1 at 31-30. The gutsy call going for 2 points. It's not to be. Miami wins it 31-30. So, who is the national champion? Is it Miami? Is it Auburn? Or is it Nebraska? All have just one loss. Nebraska's gutsy call may have lost them the game going for 2 points, but it may have won them some votes. We'll find out 6:30 tomorrow night. Len Berman in New York.
Thank you, Len. 31-30, the final score. Miami the victor. And now let's go down to the Miami locker room to Bill McAtee. Bill?
Okay, thank you very much, Don Kricke. Bernie Kosar, I think somebody forgot to tell you you were a freshman. You hung in there, showed a lot of poise. Your line did a terrific job.
I'll tell you, today, the offensive line, they really haven't been getting much credit all season. And there's the guys like right there, Ian St. Clair, Paul Berticelli, my roommate, Alvin Ward, you know, all of Dave Heffernan and Juan Carmen. That's a heck of a group. And I'll tell you, those guys, they said they give their life for me, and I think they just about did today.
I know Nebraska plays a lot of man, and there was no doubt that you felt you could throw on.
Yeah, we went into the game thinking that, you know, we were going to be able to throw the ball. We tried to, we tried to mix it up early, and I think we did in the first quarter. But in the second quarter, we kind of got out of our game plan, kind of started throwing the ball too much. But, you know, we got back into it the third quarter, and were able to move the ball.
You had a couple of new plays in there. I know one of the touchdown passes to Dennison was new.
Yeah, I think the second touchdown we had today was at it was called 50 wide middle as a new play, and it worked well, you know, twice, a couple times today.
I want to take you back to the beginning of the season, the first week after the loss. Did you ever feel that it would come down to a moment like this?
No, never. That's the only way to describe it. I knew the team had the potential to, you know, win our games, but to end up the way it did,
know that Auburn won. Is there any question, though, in your mind who's number one?
Well, I guess it's up to the polls, but I'd say in my heart, we're number one.
Okay, Bernie Kosar.
That's the greatest coach right there.
Howard, come on over, Coach. Congratulations.
Thank you.
You know, when you spoke of this game, you spoke in terms not only of it being an important football game, but in terms of community.
Well, I think you could see out there in that stadium tonight what it really meant to this community and how totally involved and totally committed they were to this game tonight. This has been a love affair that's been developing for 5 years. And tonight was the fulfillment of a dream that, I say fulfillment, it might just be the beginning of a dream.
I want to take you back a few moments ago on the field, the gutsy call by Tom Osborne to go for two. Now, he probably could have won the national championship had they tied the ball game. Was there any doubt in your mind that he tried for two?
There was no doubt in Tom Osborne's mind. There was no doubt in my mind. He's a champion, and he went after it like a champion.
Now, one of the keys to this ball game, you said earlier in the week, was that if Nebraska scored, they had to take at least 10 plays to do it. No big plays. And when they got their touchdowns, that's exactly how they did it.
Well, it was, and that was a real reason why we were successful. The defense played a super football game. They had one really major error, but other than that, they played a great football game against a great, great Nebraska football team, and our offense came back to life and did some things pretty well, too. Bernie Kosar was super.
This was a game, obviously, for your football team of emotion, and yet you had to be a little unnerved when Mike Regier took off for 27 yards early on.
I was unnerved much of the game, because when you have those types of people in the game, you know it can break at any time. But again, the defense played a bending defense, but they didn't break very much.
Now, of course, Auburn won. Is there any question in your mind about who's number one in the country?
No, there's no question in my mind or anybody in this room's mind who's number one team in America. The Miami Hurricanes are the number one team.
Howard, there have been an awful lot of stories about you leaving the University of Miami. We have to address those now.
Well, it's just like you say, they're stories.
No truth to them whatsoever?
They're stories.
Tony Fitzpatrick, your nose guard, it was very important, you said early, for him to get in there and penetrate, and he seemed to do that.
Tony Fitzpatrick has to be the most gutty guy that I've known in a long, long time. Hadn't played a football game in 10 weeks. Scrimmaged one time for 16 plays, and then to go out and play probably 72 plays against the finest offensive line in America.
Howard, congratulations. A terrific football game. We enjoyed watching it as well.
Thank you.
31-30. The University of Miami makes its claim to the national championship. Let's go back upstairs at On Cricket.
Thank you, Bill. The emotion that's been spent this evening is as awesome as the game itself. It was just a phenomenal football game. We're just so privileged to be able to be a part of it, John.
Yeah, and I think it's all been said, Don. The whole Orange Bowl committee couldn't have drawn up a better script, and the only man that predicted it was Bob Lafferty, so he's next year's president. He gets off on a good note.
Well, it was a great, great victory, and again, when you talk about the football game, as much as the Miami victory, you have to remember the courage, the valor of Tom Osborne and the Nebraska Cornhuskers going for the win. They did not get it. The final score, Miami 31, Nebraska 30, in the golden anniversary year of the Orange Bowl. The executive producer of NBC, the coordinating producer of NBC's football coverage is Ted Nathanson. Today's telecast was produced by George Finkel, directed by John Gonzalez, technical director Lenny Stucker, associate director Joe Michaels, associate producer Antoinette Macchiaverna. Due to the length of tonight's game, the Tonight Show starring Johnny Carson will not be seen. Stay tuned for local news, followed by Late Night with David Letterman. The final numbers up on the golden anniversary of the Orange Bowl. The Miami Hurricanes, a team that started out the season losing to Florida 28-3, come back now to win 11 straight games, including this, the biggest victory in the school's history, a 31-30 upset of the number one team in the country, Nebraska. Miami doing it, led by a freshman quarterback, Bernie Kosar, playing with the skill and guile of an established veteran. He never let up, and when Miami was down and Nebraska had come back, they rally, they summon from deep within, and Miami scores one of the great football victories in the college game ever. So glad you could be with us.